I edit out dance farts and burps.
I usually just try and like move away from the mic.
Are we live?
Just,
are we live yet? Before
we are now.
Just went live. Oh, yeah.
Just
we'll talk about a fart story later.
I was just gonna say there was one time when we were recording and I farted like really loudly, and we just started laughing.
That was the very last 90s.
Yeah, it was.
And there's
a moment where we just start like, "Oh, it was an inside joke."
It's like something out the window.
Yeah, I was just so happy that the fart didn't show up on the audio. But now I've told everyone.
It actually does if you listen. Yeah. So not bringing attention to it because you could just go, "Oh, that was a something with no cables."
It was Jeff in the background.
A photon.
Woo.
Oh boy.
We live yet?
Yeah, we are.
I can't see my own face.
It's all right.
You don't need to see it.
Your beard looks pretty right. Manly.
I just trimmed it. My bathroom's gross right now.
See, this is I trimmed it at the beginning of the year, and now at the beginning of March I go to Ohio for the Arnold Sports Classic, so I won't shave till after that.
Nice.
There you go.
And I will look full blown homeless that weekend.
Why does it now say we are the only ones here?
You're not.
We're not. You're Matt.
I don't know.
Are we in another Hangouts call? I think we're in two Hangouts calls.
I'm going to close
That's
this
possible.
Hangout call. I'm going to close this Hangout call just because I'm assuming it's also eating up bandwidth.
Hopefully we won't get disconnected.
Still here?
Yeah, but
well,
I lost
can't see
camera.
You now.
Oh, shit.
Couldn't just fucking leave well enough alone.
Okay, are we back?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, good. Yeah. Don't touch anything. Hit cancel. All right, good. That was weird.
I don't know. I don't understand computers.
No.
It amazes me we go to space. Like
we don't really go to space.
You don't.
But I mean, like, I can't get Google Hangouts to work. Like, there's never like a glitch in space where it's just like, oops, oxygen stopped.
The blue screen of death.
Yeah.
That turns into literal death.
I mean, how often does your phone or something crash?
Pretty often.
Yeah, the spaceships don't crash.
But there's no like malware on the mirror.
But is that what is causing it? I thought it was just because
no.
So
it's just
the spaceships are running a Commodore 64 chips. They will never crash.
They're impenetrable. To modern Russian hacking.
Much like my wife's pants.
Oh, boy.
The Russian part?
No, her pants are impenetrable. Because I never get any.
Your wife is blessed with a small amount of memory.
Oh, jeez, that was good.
Like a 51st date type situation.
I'll be outside.
Her keyboard's got no sex button.
Wait, they make keyboards with sex buttons?
I can't do computer puns because
no.
I don't
there
know.
There's a joystick port. I don't know.
Why does my wife have a joystick port?
I don't know.
She asked herself. See what she did there.
You have it with her.
She really wore out her escape key.
I used to
she doesn't want to have sex with you.
Yes.
All that divorce.
I was trying to page down her pants. That wasn't very good.
She says, "Hey, man."
I'm like staring at my keyboard, like, "What key can I make fun of now?" Function, alt function.
I think she's looking for a pause break.
God damn it!
The word game I was talking about off air. One of the main parts of the game was you would have to come up with a funny analogy. I'm going somewhere here.
No, sorry, I got something.
And it's like. She's like a water bottle, and then you fill in the analogy. So somebody would put half drunk and rolling around in the back seat, something like that. So one day the clue, the prompt was he's like a space bar. And, you know, 80% of us did like computer jokes. But for some reason, a small part of people thought they meant like the cantina.
I went right to Mos Eisley.
Yeah, no. How, when you see the term space bar, how is the first thing you think? Oh, the place where you can get alcohol outside of Earth.
The first thing I thought of when you said he's like a space bar was he doesn't like you. I don't like you.
You know what they should do with those characters? Put them in another Star Wars movie for no reason. And then have them miraculously survive a nuclear explosion.
Yep. Yeah. That would be great. But we're not here.
That was basically the equivalent of doing the redo of episode 4 and throwing the Jabba the Hutt scene and Boba Fett in there for no fucking reason at all. Let's repeat all the dialogue we just did in the last scene.
You mean you don't like when Han Solo steps on Jabba the Hutt's tail and he goes, burr, burr.
They should have had Jyn Erso step on his balls chin.
He's a ball chinian.
He's a ball chinian. What is that from?
Men in Black 2.
That's right, yeah, yeah.
That gem of a movie.
That's one of the best lines of that movie.
That's not a good movie. I did like 3, though.
It has its moments. It just needed more stuff in it.
Yeah, it had Rosario Dawson just looking beautiful, so that's all that fucking matters.
Rosario Dawson. She is.
Whew. Is this our Men in Black 2 podcast?
Could be.
It could be. I'm waiting patiently for my dogs to stop barking because my wife's about to come in. That's why my mic's off and I'm staring deep into Jack's eyes.
I do hear your dogs. Let's get them in here on the podcast.
Fuck no. I'm not wrangling 3 shit sippers right now. Maybe later. Maybe later when we're all liquored up.
Towards the end.
Towards the end when we stop giving a shit about everything.
Exactly.
Only halfway there. I had to roll my pants up because I'm getting sweaty already. So that's how. And we're off to a good start.
Boy, I'm tired of life.
Yeah. Oh. This is it.
We're gonna kill myself after this podcast.
I'm gonna kill Jack after this podcast.
So by the way, waited for me to go live on YouTube so you could read your suicide note.
This is our network.
Forever be out there.
This is our network. Except instead of some kind of subversive take on mainstream media, we're talking about
Men in Black 2.
Some Men in Black 2.
By the way, he's like a space bar. The answer is you double bang him after a period.
There you go.
Oh,
except that's incorrect. Apparently, you're not supposed to do 2 spaces after.
I never do 2 spaces.
Really? I always do.
I just submitted writing project and they asked for double spaced.
Really?
Yeah.
No, strange. About 4 years ago, I think. Yeah, about 4 years ago, I was told that you can no longer do that, and I was like, fuck that. I'm going to do it till the day I die. Cool. And I surprisingly, within a week, I pretty much had, I can now I automatically do a single space. Because a friend of mine wrote a novel and sent it to a publisher, and they made him go back and they were like, we will not accept a double space. And he went back and literally took a space out instead of just, you know, doing a find all 2 blank spaces and replace all with a single.
Yeah, that's all you got to do. That's so much easier than doing the reverse.
Yeah, he did it manually. Jesus. But yeah, no, ever since I switched. And you know what? I, as a traditionalist, I really don't give a shit. Single space.
Yeah.
Comes in handy in Twitter.
I only started doing it because a couple friends of mine I was writing with on Prodigy back in the day were doing it. I'm like, what the hell is this shit? I'd never heard of it because I didn't take any writing classes.
Yeah.
But we didn't type when I went to school. We banged shit out on
the thing. Yeah.
Right.
A double space is a typewriter thing.
It's a typewriter.
It was always single space before, and after, just for whatever reason, typewriters, there's a reason.
Well, what if I stand up this? Like, yo, you ever notice? What's the deal? You ever notice this Jason in space?
While I talk about typewriters. You ever notice about typewriters where you do double space?
It's so weird that all we can see is Jack's crotch, and the mic is so close to Dan's mouth. It's just like an elongated blowjob.
What's the deal?
Which has got to make Jack so happy because elongated and blowjob.
We are lying
in Jack's junk.
Yeah, this is forever on YouTube unless I get this video pulled down.
It's one of my jeans too, with the zipper sinks down gradually throughout the day and makes very awkward interactions.
Oh, you mean all of your jeans, Jack?
There's a couple that work still.
We know you're up.
Missy's slowly attaching keychains to my zippers, and then I wrap the keychain around the button.
I've seen that.
I ran out of keychains.
I used to use safety pins until one popped off and poked me in the dick.
Ooh. Why are you guys' zippers like all breaking?
They just drift down.
That's never happened to me once.
I think it's because I got fat.
That's probably my fault too.
Literally, my stomach pushed out on the zipper.
I guess. All right, I guess
let me free.
Free
No, I zipped up my pee-pee once. It was so painful. I did it at work in my gross bathroom. And oh my God. Yeah, there was blood. And
I zipped up my pee-pee once.
Oh, it hurt so bad.
Jack McCone.
I got shampoo in my pee hole once and then peeing for like a day burnt. It was.
That's why you fuck the conditioner bottle, not the shampoo bottle.
There's no
you
more
rinse and then repeat.
I paid too much for my conditioner to put my dick in it.
Is this a special edition of Podcast Terror? What did you get in your pee hole?
Well, I'm not actually recording the episode yet, so none of this is going to be on it.
I mean, we've been recording.
But guys are recording.
We do want it. We have it.
I mean, this gives us the opportunity to do a next week where we just put out the excerpts.
Yeah. You may have to send me your recording so that we can just. All right.
This counts as a 90th percentile. That way we don't have to do another one next week.
Yeah, let's just put this out. Dicking around before another podcast.
I did get my hands on a bottle of beer called Y2K. So if for any reason you guys ever ask me to come back on 90th percentile, I'm saving it for that. All right, I'm going to save that bottle of beer till the day I die.
But this is like a current beer. It's not like leftover from
the Y2K.
They
really?
No, they rebrewed it. Made it for Y2K and rebrewed it in 2015.
Me and Dan were talking during the movie about 2000 stuff. Oh, we weren't talking about Y2K. We were talking about how they put the number 2000 after like Blues Brothers
2000.
Dracula 2000.
Yeah.
Yep.
That Full House Hairspray Guard, the 3001.
2001.
Good episode.
Full House is
actually a great episode.
Yeah. Jack, the Giants lost 38-13.
38-13. Man, they really got their asses kicked.
Yeah.
We live yet?
is that your shtick for the show? I'm okay with it.
We're gonna run it into the ground. We studio style.
Please do.
I can't hold my mic. I sound like I'm in a fucking Weather Channel reporter out on the beach.
We're live on the Eastern Seaboard, and things are getting a little intense.
I can even do this. Now just hold this. This is more difficult.
Right. You need to wrap a bandana around that shit and rock it.
Yeah, why don't we just do this? Why don't we just hold the whole table? Hey guys, I'm much more comfortable.
I just want to be able to sit back and enjoy myself, Jack.
You guys probably have no idea who Chuck Billy is, do you?
Chuck Billy? No.
All right, Chuck Billy is the singer.
Charles William.
Chuck Billy is the singer from the band Testament.
Oh, yeah, I know
Testament. I've heard of Testament, yeah.
Okay, so He has a half mic stand on stage with them. I'm trying to find a good picture.
A half mic stand?
Yeah, literally. Because he. Yeah.
So I'm still talking about Rosemary Dawson.
That's why
what happened
to the show?
All right, here you go. So that's him. He has a whole half mic stand so he can play air guitar. So the black part is like literally where it ends.
That's what she said.
Why? Why would you do that?
I don't know. He's a fucking weirdo. But he's Chuck Billy of Testament, so he can do whatever he wants.
All right, well.
Is it a religious band?
No.
Oh, no. I always assumed Testament was like a heavy metal Christian.
No, that was the joke on the Simpsons where they were going to have Testament. The rock stylings of Testament were going to come to the church. But
I guess
like
just assumed they were both.
It's You're like thinking
we have a very religious. We had a very religious friend who you had Testaments. Remember?
I do remember that.
His gum. He had Christian themed gum.
Oh, jeez.
Testament.
I really like Chuck Billy back when he was in the WWF and went by Jimmy Superfly Snuka. Oh,
God. I definitely see that. Just acquitted for murder, right?
Yeah. Because his brain is so fucked up, they're like, we're not going to charge him.
Yeah. Oh, God. Not guilty by reason of insanity. I don't think that's what it actually was, but basically it was that.
Well,
but anyway.
It's the best way to be considered not guilty.
Did you just pop your arm out of the socket?
I did that too. I'm Riggs.
Check this out. Ooh, you hear that?
Yeah, I hear it.
Ugh. I can only do it with my right shoulder.
I can pop it all out now. It's all creaked out. You gotta give me like
what weird body things do you guys have?
What's in your
my left ball is bigger than my right ball.
Is that the ball that doesn't exist? You always tell me you have one that wasn't there.
It's there. It just doesn't work.
Oh, okay. Well, that's something
interesting.
So what's it? I
don't want to know.
This is a true story.
It was like Polly Pocket living next to an empty apartment. I didn't understand what you meant then.
No. I was born with a hernia, so like one just doesn't work.
Gotcha.
I'm sorry. Is that inappropriate? tells me they were born with something horrible, I just...
response is laughter.
I was born with an unresponsive twin.
There's no response! Oh boy!
I'm great at baby food.
Holy shit!
I'll do this.
Oh boy!
What's the deal? and I look like this because the coffin's so small. So just. All right. That's enough of that baby talk for.
If
see you in 2018.
You burned it out in the first 10 days of the year, huh?
Yeah. Oh boy. What are we doing? Are we doing a podcast?
I don't know.
Yeah, we're going to whenever you guys are ready.
Yeah, we're ready.
I'm ready.
Oh, I mean, you don't have to be ready.
Very symmetrical now. Dan fucked up the framing that I spent so much of my...
I don't know why you spent so much time on... Because
I went to film school. It makes me feel like I didn't waste $200,000.
Okay. Hey, that's all you had to say. You don't got to get all fucking uppity.
Speaking of the guy at the bar from trivia the other night.
Yeah.
when the sound went out, he's the bartender. He was like, I went to film school. I'll figure it out. He didn't figure it out.
I didn't want to embarrass myself. I didn't even bother.
Well, Bryce also did look, and he didn't figure it out either. The answer was something was unplugged.
That's what I was saying.
I know. Well, whatever. Anyway, you guys don't care about this.
I
lean back
now. I care about everything.
I listen to you guys for like 2 hours a week. It's important to me to hear as much of this as possible.
Breathe it in. Get it while you can. I don't even know when our next episode of anything is coming out.
We said we were going to come back. Well, The Simpsons will come back.
Next Thursday.
I mean, we have a three-hour episode of We coming out this Thursday, but...
Oh, right. We're doing
the unedited one.
Raw of the
raw and uncut. The only 5 minutes I cut was when something happened. There was some technical difficulty. Oh, my phone exploded. My battery.
Right. This was our drunken New Year's episode. Which
I put my iPhone
record
up against the TV. Usually we have it against the bottom of the TV, against the speaker, but this time we had it against the screen and it just got really hot. And the iPhone said, nope, turned itself on.
I left my phone in my car once in the middle of summer and that happened.
Yeah, we did
decided it was done.
The last two thirds of our New Year's episode was recorded with the iPhone leaning against my lunchbox.
Ice pack. It worked.
It did. I MacGyvered the shit out of it.
And then Jack had lunch.
Attaboy.
And my pudding was there and everything.
You have a turkey sandwich with no crusts?
God.
Does your girlfriend cut the crusts off your sandwich for you?
No, because I make them myself because I'm
I'm a big boy.
SJW cack.
Cuck. Wait, what?
Cook. Oh God.
Listen to our raw New Year's episode. We go into detail about cack and cook.
And then listen to our SmackDown New Year's episode. Wrestling joke. Anyone?
I like wrestling.
I'm like behind. I gotta start watching Raw again.
Even bother.
I watched SmackDown a couple weeks ago, but
what's the?
We should tweet out a link, right?
If you want, you don't have to. No one's gonna come.
No one's gonna come.
Except me. Sorry.
I don't even know what we would link to.
Hey, what's... Siri, where are you?
Up your butt.
Oh fuck yeah!
Up your butt.
So Fastlane is in Milwaukee in March, and it's a Raw event. It's the day I come back from Ohio, so my wife's gonna be real happy because then the next day I fly to San Francisco for work.
Nice.
But it's Raw, which means Corey, this will make more sense to you, but Gary's buddy TJ Perkins will be there.
I know TJ Perkins.
Yeah, I knew you know TJ, and Corey knows Gary.
Right.
Yeah. So we put our knowledge together.
It makes you seem super cool.
Yeah.
Is he? No, he's not the champ anymore. Brian Kendrick's the...
Yeah, I fucking hate that guy. Just his
face. I like Brian Kendrick.
His face makes me want to punch an old woman.
The Brian Kendrick? All right.
He's the man with it.
By the way, Ashley is watching, so...
Well, I know. Shut up. She was.
For him. It's Hello? A common boy's name as well.
It's true.
You're putting your watch on mute there, Jack?
From Evil Maybe.
I keep mine on a mute all the time.
I for some reason when I had it on mute, my vibrating wouldn't work, and I was like, "Well, then what's the point?" But now all of a sudden it is, and so I'm not touching anything because that's exactly what I want—no sounds, but I still feel every notification.
Well, the weird thing is remembering what vibration pattern is what notification.
Yeah, you don't really want to spend the time turning your wrist and looking.
All the time, and the drunker I get, the closer to my face I put it. So if it goes off, you're just doing this.
Oh God!
I love my watch. It's so useful.
I love my computer. I love my Apple Watch.
I didn't put it on yesterday because I was just like, I was literally too.
There's the link if we want
to
tweet it out.
Too hungover and tired to get my watch from the bedroom, and I really did feel naked without it because I won't text. I was telling Dan I don't text without it anymore. I don't
you
like
use that. It to respond a lot.
If you ever notice when you get texts from me, the words don't quite make sense. Like, oh, what was it before? Oh, I told Dan I was broke, too broke to go get food.
Oh, yeah.
I said I was broke in because I said broke end. And so it's like, I'm broken. Like, yeah. You want to go get some Chipotle? I'm broken.
I know you're broken. And I assumed that that's what happened.
I lost that link. And it's gone forever.
Fuck it. Let's just start.
With the link to the YouTube?
Yeah.
If you click the little chat icon over to the left.
Oh, see.
At the top left.
We're chat.
Maybe if you
there's a little chat. Oh, so we could say stuff to each other that the readers, the watchers won't know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fart. Somebody said they had a really weird boner right now.
I like that it implies that it's not weird the rest of the time.
Right.
Well, right now it's weird. All right, fine. Now, come on, guys. I got a weird boner.
Right now, my right boner now looks like Steven Seagal.
And it's weird because
yellow sunglasses on.
It's like I shouldn't have a boner, but I got a boner. So it's a weird boner.
Good boy. You're better, but nobody else uses it.
Wait till age gets you, and it's just like, oh, right on, boner. Amazing.
Oh, you still work? Dan, what episode of The Simpsons where the old man's punching himself in the dick? Or is that Family Guy?
Sounds like Family Guy. Yeah, I don't know that one.
I believe that's a Cosby show.
I drank away a lot of my memory, so your ability to recall Simpsons episodes and the names is just gives me a weird boner.
It's one of the only things I'm good at.
When you guys did Seinfeld at one point, I was like, holy shit, you know, because same level as what you guys do with The Simpsons. But it was
just, yeah. I might be even stronger with Seinfeld just because, well, no, I guess there's not more episodes.
I feel like I watch Seinfeld more now than I watch The Simpsons. Like, as far as in my life, I've definitely seen The Simpsons more. But
before 2 years ago, I hadn't watched an episode of The Simpsons or an episode of Seinfeld since college. But it's just in there from watching back in the day. Eventually, we're going to get my co-writer and partner, Frank, on one of the podcasts. He's probably what Dan is The Simpsons, he is the Seinfeld. He just has every episode completely memorized.
I tried going back and watching Seinfeld and gave up after like three episodes.
Really? Oh, it's so good.
I mean, the first season is not great, but even the first season has its moments, but
I don't know. There's like two different shows.
I feel like Seinfeld and The Simpsons are just baked into who I am.
Mm-hmm. What was I watching? Oh, I was watching Conan O'Brien, hypothetically.
Hypothetically.
And I realized that
or apathetically.
Oh, I get it.
Do you ever watch Regular Show?
I was smoking marijuana while I was watching it.
I've seen Regular Show, yeah.
And anyway, I realized a lot of your on-air tics, not intentionally, I'm assuming, it's just naturally.
It's just baked in. Yeah,
Conan is a huge Conan O'Brien.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You're like, if Conan O'Brien and Scott Aukerman had a baby,
that's
before they either of them had met 31 years ago.
That is the greatest compliment anyone has ever paid me.
That is really fucking awesome, man.
Who had sex for me?
I don't know, a dish rag and a pile of hair.
I wish a pile of hair.
Dish rag and Chewbacca.
Yes, I know where they get the jeans from. It's all dish rag.
Oh,
the hair jeans went to my asshole.
That's probably where the dish rag needs to go. I mean, put a knot in it for your pleasure, but still.
Now you gotta read it from our other ones, or
holy shit!
Just leave it.
If you want to retweet it, I was gonna do Facebook.
Yeah, actually, I'll retweet it. Oh no! I just closed literally everything.
I'll tweet it.
We're ready. We'll do the show.
Yeah, we're
ready.
Yeah.
I was just thinking about that. Like, we should probably do that.
We could start. You guys could start.
We have work tomorrow.
We won't. Yeah, we won't talk for the beginning, or will we?
Dan will.
You don't know that.
All right. I guess I'll start this.
Ooh, I just got a vibration on my retweeted by Podcast of Terror. Hey.
I'm going to start texting you the whole time just so your wrist blows up. fucking show dog. All right.
Okay. Good enough.
Welcome to episode 73 of the Podcast of Terror.
Talking right over the intro.
This is a production of the Galactic Network. This is a podcast about all things scary. I'm your host, Matt Stein. With me, as always, is Corey. I get uncomfortable when guys tell me about their weird boner, Scott. Corey,
how are you? I get uncomfortable because it's supposed to be show, don't tell. I think that's the best thing in life is to understand in basic life. I want to see the boner. I want to know. You can't tell me it's weird and not give an example.
I'm wearing sweatpants, which means
learned my taste.
Sweatpants enhance the thickness of my boner, makes it look real killer. You could describe it as a killer pillar. Just go out in public, just showing people my boner.
Has anybody described it as a killer pillar ever?
Yeah. Not my penis, just penis in general. Yes.
Okay.
Maybe never mind.
A caterpillar.
Mine's more the Leaning Tower of Pisa.
I was going to say Tower of Babel. Kind of
hooks to the left. It's got this the swing motion. If you're a football fan, it's got a slant route. It's a slant route into the end zone. This week,
right up your butt.
God damn it! I'm trying to introduce our guests.
Okay,
please introduce us.
You started this.
I really want to talk.
Don't shush me, Jack. I want to talk.
Don't say my name.
Take away your power.
Wow. This week we're joined by the beautiful masterminds behind Wii Studios Creators, the worst episode ever, which is a Simpsons podcast if you're dumb, and 90s percentile Jack Bacone and Dan Mulhall.
Oh, all right. That's awesome. We get an air raid whistle when we come in.
How are you guys?
That happened when the nukes were coming.
Wait, oh my God.
Do I dance or do I pray?
That took like four motions at once for me to do. So I hope you guys really appreciate
it. We totally appreciate that. Thank you for having us. How's it going, Corey and Matt?
Well, you say that like we just started. If you're listening to the audio of this, we've literally been probably, it's almost an hour we've been talking
for a while. Yeah.
I know this is a huge surprise, but I'm drinking.
Yeah, you told me we were going to keep it classy tonight, so we're just drinking straight up bourbon.
You never told me that we were keeping it classy, so I just brought like bourbon.
I'll show the text on the webcam right now. You said keep it classy.
I think he meant
never
classy.
Said yes. We're going to keep it classy, you son of a bitch. So I just brought bourbon barrel aged beer.
Well, that sounds good.
That sounds very yummy.
Now, didn't you put maple syrup in your bourbon though? Isn't that what I heard pre-show?
I did. I've kind of very recently, I've kind of like lost the taste for whiskey and bourbon. Like I want girl drinks now. I want something that's yummy going down. Although now that I'm drinking the maple syrup, but it actually, I was just like, oh man, I like whiskey again. Good.
That's why you're having that Malibu Bay breeze when I walked in.
I had a bunch of cocktails the other night at an office party that had maple syrup in it. But there was
I've never heard of a cocktail with maple syrup.
There was like six other ingredients, but literally the only thing in my fridge was maple syrup and blueberries. And I just called an audible.
Wow.
I think I heard of a bacon whiskey before. And so that sounds like it would have maple syrup added to it. It sounds awesome.
My sister-in-law must really want me to be fat and an alcoholic because last year for Christmas, she got me maple whiskey. And this year, she got me bourbon barrel-aged maple syrup.
Is this your wife's sister or your brother or sister's wife?
Oh, it's my wife's sister.
Don't you feel like there should be a different name for those types of animals? Because that could mean anything.
Right.
Well, I know none of them listen to this, I can say that my brother's wife I would just refer to as a bitch. But
Boy. Let's hope they're not watching. I'm going to finally check out my friendly brother-in-law's podcast.
I don't even think they know. Yeah, I don't even think they know I do a podcast.
Well, they're very engaged with your life, Matt.
Well, you know, if you want, I could get a couple more beers. We could have a therapy session instead of a podcast.
Do it. That's
record the whole thing.
Call them live on air.
You guys want to call in? I'll give you out my phone number.
Let's start a new podcast called Shitty Therapy, where we just like let people.
I want to kill myself. Okay.
What a dumb idiot.
Check out our Amazon links.
I just saw that.
73 people killed themselves that day.
Wow.
That'd be good ratings for us.
All of the listeners. Yeah, that'd be amazing.
73 would be fucking awesome to start with.
Amazing.
Yeah.
I mean, they wouldn't be coming back for the second episode, but
hopefully at their funeral,
would they
mention the podcast
while jumping off the bridge. We podcast. I
know we get most of our listeners now.
from suicide. From suicide. You look and it tells you the source of your traffic, and it's number one is suicide notes. Number two is Google.
Yeah.
Number three is suicide notes again.
But different.
Parentheses Spanish.
Bing is just like, what the fuck? We never win. We never win. Suicide beats us out twice.
Yeah.
No, you need to start sponsoring people's suicides. So when they kill themselves at the suicide tunnel, this suicide brought to you by Wii Studios.
Great idea. Actually.
That is an untapped market, Matt, and we have dibs on it now.
That's fine. We're maxed out on listeners. There's literally no one else in the world that watches horror movies that we can get into.
All right.
We got all 11 of them.
Nice. That's tough. That's a tough get. That 11th guy he's an asshole.
I had to write him a letter to his house. I sent him a cake. Finally, I had to go over there and I had to jerk him off.
Jeez.
What
are we going to get for being on the show?
Yeah, really?
I want
cake.
Well, the next time someone brings you cupcakes, just know they came with love from Matt.
Oh, boy. Oh, dear.
Well, you know, you guys got a box of beer, which Jack drank.
Yeah, I never got any of that, Jack.
That was for me. It was just for me.
I'll take cheese, Matt.
We're gonna the next gonna, bottle of beer we send out your way,
so that I can circumvent the jack.
The next beer we send out your way will be Bologna flavored.
I like it.
Do they make Bologna beer?
Not yet.
Bologna beer is a great name, though.
Bologna beer is a great name.
We should start a brewery.
We're taking that too.
We should. We'll be like Drew Carey and his buddies on Drew Carey's show.
That's exactly right.
Start our own fun beer.
But just as long as they're not like his brother, the Zodiac Killer.
That's a deep cut.
Wow.
I hope he doesn't die in lava in volcano.
Remember when Drew Carey's brother impregnated Francis McDormand in Fargo?
I remember when he was killed by...
Oh, fuck, yeah.
He played the autistic kid from Pet Sematary in Full House's dad.
So we have taken over this podcast.
This is the...
and we're just talking about Drew Carey's brother.
This is the... what's a John Carroll Lynch podcast.
Yes, that's his name.
So let me know when you guys are ready so I can, you know, do the next part of the show. Yeah.
Ding! Put a counter right there.
I wish I had a golf counter.
Oh, yeah, I got index cards.
What? The fuck are the index cards? Why are you wasting
paper? He's literally taken off his headphones and walked away from the screen to retrieve index cards.
We should move on with the show while this is happening.
All right.
Get into the regular stuff.
All right. For more on this podcast, including show notes, contact information, subscription links, you can go to gncast.com/pot. You can chat with us on our Slack channel during our shows at gncast.com/signup. While you're there, you can subscribe to our newsletter as well. Podcast Terror is spoiler heavy, so if you haven't seen Jason X, you're going to want to watch it here. If you need taking a card from Jack and Dan, if you need an Amazon link so that we can get some of that sweet, sweet money that you make, go over to the show notes. There's a little link. You can click on it. You'll get the movie. We get some money. And then I never see the money, so
I don't even know if it
is
exists.
It invisible?
Is Amazon real? Is Amazon
made up?
Amazon is the greatest scam that Jeff Bezos ever pulled.
I don't know, man. I'm sure you guys have a distribution center nearby, right?
Yeah, I think we do, because sometimes I can package the same day.
Yeah, we now have one in it's south of Milwaukee. So if I drive like down to Illinois, I'll see it, and it's like the size of a city.
Yeah.
They're pretty
enormous.
It's incredible.
There's one in Jersey for sure.
And the workers are miserable.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure they're just going to deliver it by Hindenburg anyway. So
that double butt Zeppelin that you see that? It's like the world's largest
double butt Zeppelin.
Yeah. It's like if they want it to be like the next thing of travel. And it's a giant Zeppelin, but it looks like a big butt.
This is like the 30s when everyone thought like Zeppelin travel was going
to
be a thing.
I'm from the 30s. I traveled into the future to tell you about this. This incoming Zeppelin surge. No, it's this new thing. It's been, you didn't, I think it was like,
I didn't know. I never heard about the new Zeppelin surge. That sounds ridiculous.
Google new Zeppelin and then put an advanced filter, not Robert Plant music.
Yeah, right. All right, I'll look that up later. We're recording a podcast right now. I don't know if you knew
this. Are we live?
Wait for it.
He didn't pre-write the
numbers. Yeah, you should pre-write
the numbers. I broke the marker.
There goes that great bit.
It's all permanent. Guys, I mean, at this point, you can use your fingers, Jack. It's okay.
Yeah, until we get to 11, you're okay.
Just got total ass shot.
So what's going on in the podcast of Terror world, huh?
I was waiting so long for Jack to come back with that number two. The card written number two, not just like a turd in his hand.
He's done that too.
It probably would have shits
in his hand. He goes, see what I mean.
Yep, that's not that far off. There we go.
Wait, up.
Can't even see it.
There it is.
There.
You
go. Oh,
it inverted.
It looks like a six to us.
Are we inverted?
Yeah, we're inverted. It looks like a Z.
Are our shirts inverted?
Yeah.
You guys should take your shirts off. We'll see if your nipples are inverted too.
Podcast.
I guess I'll do it inverted too.
No,
you're not inverted for us.
Not inverted for the people watching. What the fuck is that? What is this?
I don't know how to
what is this supposed to be? Can you even see this?
Uh-uh.
I need a better marker.
There it is. That's an S.
Yes, that's not a number.
I don't know how to draw.
To them, it's a five.
I'm not. I didn't go to the Navy.
What?
They train you how to write backwards on those clear plastic.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Did we watch Top Gun?
I've watched Top Gun. The Top Gun was about the Air Force. The fuck are you talking about the Navy?
Can we redo this?
Can we start over?
Can we start another
take? Are we live?
Hey, everybody, this is Worst Podcast of Terror Ever.
By the end of it, I'm sure that'll be the consensus or the best.
Are we live?
Come on.
There you go. That's right. You get it ready. We're going to have to do, we're going to have to create the hippocampus scale. Make this the worst podcast of terror ever. All right. Let's do some news quick.
Did we plug our podcast or we just said,
oh shit. No, do that.
Hey everybody, you should listen to our podcast. Yeah, if you like,
it's so good.
They're great. If you like two assholes being dicks, wepodcast.com. That's wepodcast.com. We got Worst Episode Ever where we watch post-classic Simpsons episodes and rip them apart.
Which I'm still waiting to get an invite back on to just...
We'll see. And then 90s Percentile, which is an episode where Jack and I take random 90s topics from our listeners and just kind of talk about them.
Do sync points where we watch movies and you can sync up a commentary track we recorded like Air Force One and Superman Returns, Batman 89, Poochie.
I should have done one for Jason X.
We realized too far into watching Jason X because we watched it together literally right before we started recording this. So we should have done a sync points while we were watching it and gotten like the most bang for our buck. We could have released it tomorrow, upstaged you guys. It would have been great.
It really doesn't take much.
We are going to do one by Earth Day. We have an Earth
Day.
Yes,
we have a weird
planned.
Yes, we have something in the works.
And it's not.
It's not volcano.
2012. Tomorrow never die. What's the?
It's not the day after tomorrow.
The day after tomorrow.
Does it start with a B?
It's not that either. I don't know what
Damn
it is.
It's
B. I got so excited. I thought it was Biodome.
It's B movie.
We should do it. We should do a B movie.
We could do B movie. You like jazz?
It's a line from the movie.
Oh, I know it is. My
money was on Hacker, but okay.
I was just really looking for it. I thought it was Biodome. I got excited.
We could do Biodome.
That's a 90s movie.
It's a fucking great movie.
What's the one with Aaron Eckhart that drills in the middle of the earth?
A core.
That is a 2000. Yeah.
That is such. I guess it's 2003. But it is such a 90s disaster movie.
I've never seen it.
It's like if you bought the book, How to Write a 90s Disaster Movie, that's it, beat by beat.
I bet the script was written.
DJ Qualls is like, well, can I get Hot Pockets?
Dude, I almost bought Hot Pockets today.
Let me show you how to hack a phone using a fucking gum wrapper. All right, DJ Qualls, we're buying into that.
DJ Qualls is on Man in the High Castle. He's actually not bad in it.
I didn't know that. I should watch things.
I didn't know either until I started watching. I was like, hey, it's that guy.
Is that show good? I watched like two episodes and could not get into it.
It's not bad. It's not. I had low expectations because I heard it was bad, and it's competent.
By the way, I like that when we started recording the show, it was no different than when we were not starting the show before and we were just dicking around talking about whatever the fuck we were talking about.
Yeah,
and
that is our show.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. That's fine.
Wait.
I thought there was going to be news or something.
I'm trying to get into it, but I also would rather hang out and talk.
All right. Well, let's do that then.
Are we live?
Are we live?
Are we on? I don't think this is real yet.
There it is.
That looks like a squiggle to me, Jack.
A couple of wavy lines.
That is amazing.
You can keep your $5, man.
Wow. I didn't know there'd be electric shocks. Let's just quote really obscure Ghostbusters lines the rest of this podcast.
See, it was more of a game show host.
I just want to like twirl around like he did in that scene.
Who is that guy?
So there's news.
I was waiting for an opening. Yeah, there's some news. We'll try and get through these quick so we can get back to fucking around. The movie called The Chucky has been announced. There's a trailer and a plot summary has been released.
A movie called what?
Cult of Chucky.
Oh, a new Chucky movie. I just watched. I didn't even know it existed. My brother wanted
Curse
to watch
of Chucky.
It. Yeah, like it was a.
It was pretty good.
It was like a pared down, like reboot sort of.
It was alright. I liked it. I didn't hate it.
It was fine.
It's fine. Yeah, I don't second that.
Is this going to be like a sequel to that? Same kind of low budget idea. Cult of Chucky is going to be about like the cult, like a bunch of people.
It's about the band, the Cult. No, the at the very end of the
Cult of Chucky.
Curse of Chucky. The original kid came back, like in a post credit scene.
Yeah.
I think Cult of Chucky has him in it, right?
Which Hobbit was that?
No, that was his son, was Billy Boyd.
Oh.
Yeah.
His name was like Chuck or
Seed of Chucky.
Oh, his, was his daughter that was the star of the movie turned evil in the post credits?
No, 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 no. The kid from the original Child's Play movie is coming back.
It's not Justin Whalen, is it?
I don't know who that is.
He played the kid in Child's Play 3. He was also the
second
Jimmy Olsen on Lois and Clark.
Right, he replaced the original Jimmy Olsen. No, it's Alex Vincent played Andy Barkley in the first Child's Play, yep. And I think came back later on. He is going to be in this, as is the character Nika Pierce, played by Fiona Dorff, who is in Curse of Chucky.
Right. Actual daughter.
Yeah,
and awesome. She was just recently on Dirk Gently's Holistic Detective Agency. She was Bart Kurlish and was awesome in that, and I didn't have any clue who she was at that point in time. But okay. She pretty much stole every episode that she, anytime really? She was on screen.
So it's not just nepotism. She's got the, because Brad Dourif's awesome. He's an underrated, what was he in that was great?
Lord of the Rings.
No, no, there's a TV show. He was an ensemble member of a TV show relatively recently. What was it? Was it Deadwood? It was Deadwood. He was great on Deadwood.
That's not that
ridiculous. I know, I'm old.
the plot description actually makes this movie sound kind of dumb.
What's the podcast?
Okay, let's hit it.
So the chick from Curse of Chucky. So it is a sequel to Curse of Chucky. Mm-hmm. She is in an asylum, and she's convinced that her, not Chucky, murdered her entire family. But when her psychiatrist introduced a new therapeutic tool, quote unquote tool, to facilitate his patients' group sessions, an all too familiar good guy doll with an innocently smiling face. Yeah, a string of grisly deaths begin to plague the asylum, and Nika starts to wonder if maybe she isn't crazy after all.
Hey, I'm into it.
Metal Asylum, that's great.
I'll watch it, but it's not like, meh.
When did they get Chucky in space?
Oh, we'll talk about that a little later.
Yeah, right.
See you for Jason X.
Now, this does bring back, like we said, it brings back the Andy character. He comes back there to try to aid Nika. And then along the way, they introduce Tiffany, which is the character played by Jennifer Tilly.
And her sweet, sweet cans.
Well, I don't know if we're going to see her sweet, sweet cans or the ones on the doll.
Either way.
Better be hers.
Fantastic boobies.
I'm looking forward to that. I think that's going to be good. I like Child's Play, the whole series.
Yeah, I wonder, you know what? I just realized that the mother in the first movie... maybe first two movies was some. I was like, I just found. I was like, oh, that was her, and now I can't remember who it was. And I was like, oh, I had
no
idea.
She was from Seventh Heaven, I think.
No. Yeah, she is from Seventh Heaven. You know what? She's from Voyage Home. She's the whale doctor.
That's right.
And I was just like, holy shit! I had no idea that was her. Because I was watching the movie. I was watching Voyage Home. I was just like, well, this lady never went nowhere. And no, she had a show for 10 years with Captain Decker before he got arrested for child pornography.
Some Seventh Heaven, am I right?
More like 7-year-olds naked.
Whoa.
That's what. I don't know what it was. Actually, I think they were older, right? No, they were young boys.
I don't remember.
Who did the guy from Seventh Heaven diddle?
I don't know. I get them confused with the other pedophiles that have been in the news in the past 5 years.
Well, R. Kelly was 13-year-old girls. Roman Polanski, also 13-year-old girls.
No, Jared was she 13?
Jared was like 13.
Roman Polanski had sex with a 13-year-old? I thought she was like 16, and it was like, all right, it's, you know, kind of on the cusp.
She was 13, and
all right, well, then he is a trash person. Not
on the cusp yet.
Yeah, pre-cusp. No. Pre-cusp.
Pre-teen and pre-cusp. Wait, is 13 pre-teen? No, I guess it's teen.
13 is teen. That is the first year of your teen.
That's my pedophile DiCaprio character.
that's a winner right there. You guys can have that character.
Just do the bit in your head. I'm not going to.
Pedo DiCaprio. Pedo DiCaprio. There we go. That's a better one. The next news story, I think. Are we done about Chucky? You guys?
Yeah, I think so.
I'm still trying to think of what
as a guest who can be the arbiter of when you're done on your bits.
I think 15 was the age of the girls Jared Fogel was having sex with.
Was he actually having
sex with? I think it was girls? It was younger. Was 15 and younger.
So I met Jared Fogel.
He's from Green 15? Bay.
It was 2004, so I was 19, going on 50. And
Jack's too hairy for Jared Fogel.
He was doing an autograph signing, and we waited in line.
Did he sign your foot long?
You waited for an autograph from the subway guy?
Yeah, and I'm really mad I lost it when I moved. And so we wait in line, and then I get there. And you know how, like, I have this, like, weird empathy for people, and I feel bad.
Yeah.
Like, I try to make everybody very comfortable and happy. So I get there, and he's signing, and I felt bad just having him sign it. So I was just like, I lost 100 pounds on your diet. Like, just to make him feel good about himself. I didn't know what to say. And he looked at me like, really? I was like, yeah. And he signed it. He's like, here you go. Anyway, while we're waiting in line, we had to wait forever because there were these two young girls, these two teenage girls, and they're like, can we try on your pants? And he's like, okay. And at the time, it was just like, we were joking, like, wow, Jared Fogle getting some.
He's
some
good
pussy.
With the young ladies.
Yeah. And no, now I get it. He was a pedophile and he was hitting on 15-year-old.
Like, I love you in my pants. Yeah, that makes
yeah, exactly.
You I love the fact that you feel bad that you lost. That was the first. Because it's going to go up in value like Hitler merchandise does. It's just like, now it's really worth
don't
something.
Bring that guy up.
What if that was the first time? What if those two girls like awoken this?
You were there for the birth for the of pedophile Jared. Good God.
I got like a cold chill. I was like,
he's feeling really down on himself. He's feeling like a lowball piece of shit that day. And all of a sudden Jack comes in and uplifts him with the story of like how he lost 100 pounds on his diet.
He's
like, I'm pretty fucking cool. I should go fuck some teenagers now.
I have sex with teenage women.
I can't get away with anything.
Babies.
I created a monster.
But nobody wants to see Marshall no more. All right. Hey, everybody. This is Podcast of Terror. Or like Podcast of Terrible.
Since I'm probably not going to tell the story, I'll probably tell it again. But one other thing about that story was he had a bodyguard who was this big, jacked, bald guy who had a black polo shirt on that said Subway. And I was just like, that's crazy that they have Subway polo
shirts.
That's
pretty awesome.
Yeah. I want one.
Yeah, I want one too.
I like Subway.
I love Subway.
I told Missy Eat today, fresh, I was like, I might get Subway for lunch. And she's like, ugh.
My wife is the same way about Subway. She does not like it. Let's just leave them and go get Subway together.
You can't tell me you don't have a better sandwich place nearby.
Of course we do. There's good sandwiches.
New York is not known for deli meats, man. I don't understand what you're
talking about. I don't think they're better sandwiches. They're just different. It's like, I love good pizza. I got great pizza in 5 different corners around my apartment, but I also like Pizza Hut.
Yeah, well, I'm not with you on Pizza Hut. Like getting Subway when I was a kid was like a treat. And
I never
had
Subway till I was 20 years old.
I was so excited when my mom was like, "We're getting Subway tonight," and I was like, "Fuck yeah!"
I just see 10-year-old Dan just fuck yeah running and just taking his shirt off, whipping it around his head.
You're not that wrong, man.
You can get double provolone tonight. What?
Double meats because you got 2 A's on your report card.
Right, I did. I earned that. No, it's no. You're good.
There you go.
We live. Are we recording?
I think we might be recording. You can actually buy Subway employee T-shirts on eBay.
Of course you can. You can buy anything on eBay. It says 6.
There it is. I needed one of you to talk so that the camera went back to you.
That's right. That's a thing.
Yeah.
It's not even that funny. A gag.
That's
great. I love it.
Does anyone listen to this?
Is it over? All right. Good night, guys.
Oh, go by
podcast.com.
Thank you very much. Good night.
Jason X. Fantastic film.
Oh, Jason
X. We still got to go through the fucking news, guys. We're
talking about Slender Man.
We got 3 more news stories to go through.
Slender Man horror movie has found its director.
It has? Really, Jack? Can you tell us more about that?
Nope.
He was missing.
That's all I got.
Sylvain White, who apparently also did Stomp the Yard. So I'm in.
That's an odd
Stomp the Yard also started as a weird Reddit meme.
It's true. Oh, are you serious?
Maybe.
On the internet, it's possible.
What's Stomp the Yard? It's dancing?
Stomp the Yard football? Was some kind of football dancing movie? I don't know. I have no idea what
Stomp. Those are the first two things
I've heard of
head.
Stomp the Yard. I feel like it's a football movie.
We're probably really racist.
It is a drama slash teen film.
But they're black, right?
I don't know if it's a black movie. Why is it black?
I thought it was.
You're thinking of Stomp the Musical.
No, I'm not thinking of that.
No,
I know what Stomp the Musical is,
but you're confusing with Stomp the Yard.
I thought it was like an urban teen movie.
I don't know. I think you're thinking of Juice.
After the death of his brother, an expert street dancer goes to Georgia to attend Truth University, but his efforts to get an education and woo the girl he likes are sidelined when he joins in his fraternity's effort to win a step dancing competition.
Step dancing.
Oh.
The
Stupid
only reference
dancing.
I've ever known of Stomp the Yard, I knew the film existed, but I never once looked twice at it, was they did a scene in the 300 parody from the Scary Movie people where
Meet the Spartans
guy. Yeah, he's like, we're going to stomp the yard. And just like,
God.
Those movies are just the worst.
Are a delight.
Makes me so mad as movies. An aspiring comedian and screenwriter.
Do you have a series of films that are made worse when you take the Wayans brothers out? And I mean the young Wayans brothers, not the ones who had talent.
Oh, God, remember Wayans Blank Jr., Man?
Awesome.
Blank Man was an awesome movie. And is an awesome movie. Well, let's not go to bed right now.
Anyway, who's what's this Slenderman movie all about?
Probably about Slenderman.
Slenderman's a Reddit thing, right?
Slenderman is like one of those creepypasta things on the old internets.
Yes.
Are you guys interested in this as horror movie podcast hosts?
Well, here's the thing. So on January 23rd, I had to look up the date before, but on January 23rd, there's an HBO documentary called Beware the Slenderman coming out on...
Right. I've heard of that.
Which That's is what a, Reddit users need, more attention.
Well,
no, it's about two teenage girls who like murdered their friend in Milwaukee.
Right, this is a real thing, and they said the Slenderman.
Yeah, yeah. So yeah. I'm more interested in that than this. Like, there's a shit ton of Slenderman movies and video games and the whole nine yards, but I kind of want to know about the kids who are fucking stupid and murdered their friend.
So it's about them. It's not about this actual...
There's two movies. No. One's an HBO documentary about these real-life kids, and this other one is like some bullshit that no one's going to see.
Stomp the Yard.
Like a slender... It's just like this slender, shadowy figure that kills people?
Well, the Bye-Bye Man looks like it's supposed to be a Slenderman knockoff, too. Also, a little bit of trivia about this show. The very first movie I got to review on Podcast of Terror with Matt was a movie he picked called Always Watching, which was about
Slenderman. You picked that movie because I'd never heard of it.
Really? Because it seemed like it came from you, because I didn't know what the fuck you were talking about when you were saying all this stuff about creepypasta.
Don't put that shit on me.
It's like a Slenderman movie? I've never heard of it.
Well,
yeah, it's a Marble Hornet story.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know what that is, but is it a good movie? I could just listen to the episode, but I won't.
Yeah, don't do that. We probably tried really hard to like be professional on that episode, so don't listen to it.
Oh, we did that on our first episode. We just found, while we were waiting to try to get this Hangouts to work, we found our very first audio recording as We Studios ever.
Yeah.
And it was just like, I'm Dan Mulhall, and this is
it was terrible.
The Simpsons. Yes, Dan, that's correct.
Yeah, we were very awkward. We'll release that, but it's not that interesting to people. That's why we bring it up on other podcasts. Woo!
Yeah, our scores were 2 and 3. That was when we had the original system.
All right, so I probably don't want to watch that.
It was it was all right. It's a found footage movie, but yeah, you can listeners, if you'd like to go back and check it out, it still exists.
Found footage movies too.
They're easy to get in. I feel like I'm there.
I feel like I'm
feels
there
real.
Too.
It's feels
like
real.
It's like someone there was this footage and someone found it, and now I'm watching it, and you know.
Oh, look, they're on the moon. There was an 18th Apollo mission. Hey.
Oh, we're stuck in this building and everyone's getting sick. It's like there's a quarantine in here. Look at that witch. Is that the Blair Witch?
Can't think of any others. What's another one? Oh, no, there's a Cloverfield monster. Oh, no, don't eat me. Oh, he ate me.
Is this an exorcism or is this The Last Exorcism Part 2?
I can't think of any more. I'm going blank.
I can't think.
I can't think of another one. A comedy one about the teenagers having a party.
Project X.
Hey, I'm a virgin.
Hey, I gotta get laid at this party. We call it Project X for some reason. I never saw that one.
Do you ever get it confused with the Project X with Matthew Broderick and the monkeys?
No, I've never even heard of that one.
Is that the one where he fell asleep driving and killed that girl?
And they were listening to the monkeys on the road. They were like,
I'm a believer. I'm dead. Oh, I'm a celebrity. It's okay.
I told you I'm going to listen to the song that's done by Smash Mouth.
Wow.
I like Matthew Broderick.
So that's it for the Slenderman story. What else you guys got?
There really wasn't much to it. It's like guy's going to do a Slenderman movie,
What's
even though there's fucking others.
It's like,
well, you guys, fiction. You're horror people.
Yeah, it's like just fan fiction. They're good stories.
Because it's like it's basically like these creepy little stories that people would write, and then people would copy and paste them everywhere.
So like copy paste creepy pasta.
So yeah, someone was eating macaroni and cheese and reading one and just choked on it and died, and they're like, "Oh, it's some creepy pasta."
I thought there was like an old Italian organ grinder like reading fortune.
You don't know it.
I'm a copy pasta.
Slender Man, he gonna kill you. You better watch out.
I can't even make a joke with you guys on here.
You better eat your meatballs or else the Slender Man going to get you.
My grandma used to always say, that's why I eat meatballs all the time. Because I was just like, no, I don't want Slender Man to get your meatballs.
Who was expecting Jack's dad to show up on this podcast?
I don't think we have enough salt or sausage for Jack's dad to be here.
I got the sausage.
Grandpa, why are you telling Jack to eat all these meatballs?
I'm your grandpa. I sound a little sausage. I know about the creepypasta, even though I died in 1922.
That's when it started, in 1922. That's the legend of the Slender Man, which I assume we'll see in the movie.
Exactly. Played by Tom Selleck.
Yeah, there you go.
I'll do Tom Selleck. I can do it. How much time we got?
I'll do Tom
Selleck.
Oh, my
God. It's very late. Let's move on to the next story.
Not that late.
Are we live?
Seven. That's number seven.
There it is.
Coming at home.
If you're not watching, probably good. You can skip through this shit.
How many people are watching? Three? Two? One?
Four? Holy shit, there's four people.
Four? All right.
We bring in the big numbers.
Hey. They're here to see us.
The winner's Chicago accent.
Hey, that's going to go all the way this year.
The Packers going to beat the Giants.
Well, the Packers did beat the Giants.
It wasn't even close.
This was a pre-recording.
It was great when we recorded all those voices before we started.
Yeah, if you're not watching this, so we actually have a button we press, and it just does random Chicago non sequiturs.
Yeah.
So you watch.
Pizza! Deep dish!
I don't want pizza. Damn it.
Saturday in the park! Oh, no, wait. It's a different button. Never mind.
I was trying to think of the Crooked Mayor, and I blanked. I blank on a lot. It's all the pot I smoke.
Oh, boy.
It makes you stare
hypothetically.
I meant Podcast of Terror. I smotch on SmoothTube.
Hey, Jack, I should probably mention that there's a man named Steven in the chat that just yelled. He exclaimed, Big Jack.
Oh, hey, Big Steve. How's it going, Steve?
Do we know who that is?
I can't see the chat. That's probably my good buddy Steve.
I mean, if you go to the YouTube link of just the YouTube video, you could see the chat too. You could participate in the chat.
When we signed up for this, you told us at max one link we had to click. This is going to be like By the way,
you don't have to. I will continue to like relay messages
every time you ask me to write a link. I'm going to put an index card with a number.
Guys, can we get through the news? I really want to know if there's going to be like a Twin Peaks Fire Walk With Me soundtrack arriving for the 25th anniversary.
By the way, Corey, I'll wait till we get to that story.
Hey, good news. There's a Twin Peaks Fire Walk With Me soundtrack arriving on vinyl for the 25th anniversary.
Oh, that's awesome. I was just wondering if there was going to be such a thing.
By the way, Corey, I just watched, on your recommendation, I finally watched all of Twin Peaks, including Fire Walk With Me, which I had to rent on Amazon. The soundtrack, it's fine. I'm not going to listen on vinyl.
I don't like soundtracks on vinyl. That's
Dan still P.
Yeah.
Right. Dan P for me, buddy.
Matt said no P for him.
The soundtrack music is the
he's usually pretty good. That's Twin Peaks spoilers. So I can't believe the dead little bomber.
I haven't finished it either, so don't spoil it. I won't remember any of this, so do whatever you want.
Although if you guys are just getting into Twin Peaks, there's a really good Twin Peaks podcast that just started called Dan Five Podcast.
They got some really nice Twin Peaks in the other room.
Yeah. Okay.
High five. High five.
Ron Richards and Tom Merritt are doing a podcast around all the episodes, and they hope to kind of finish up the series and the movie going right into the third season that should be starting this year.
When is the third season supposed to start? Because I want to finish it before then.
I want to say it's April is what we're expecting right now. I don't know if they've given us a full detailed date and time yet, but that's what it's been hinted at, is that it should be.
I loved every episode. I thought it was just such a solid show, and the music, look, the music's cool. It was so repetitive, and I'm guessing that was part of I'm David Lynch, I do weird things. Oh, that's part of it. Oh no, yeah, but it was a little too repetitive. I'm not crazy about the music.
Well, the show is supposed to be like a soap opera, and it's just that background kind of drama music, except taken to a weirder level in this. So it worked. I think the one thing about the soundtracks is you have to really, really like Julie Cruz, her singing, because it's like she's the only singer in the entire town of Twin Peaks, apparently. And the next couple of towns, like, hey, I'm going to go over to the next town. And oh, look, there's Julie Cruz again. Oh, and she gets raped and killed. But just in general.
That's what I say whenever I hear horrible rape news. Oh.
Oh. Darn it.
All right, that's something. It's better than like, woohoo!
That poor deer.
I like a lot.
At least it wasn't... No, I was gonna make
at least it wasn't women in horror festival is now seeking submissions.
Wait, I'm going to
scroll down.
Is
that story four? We're not looking at story four. Okay.
No, hey, so that's cool. If you're women in horror, this is now the time to submit to the filmfreeway.com/festival/ WIFF.
That's WIHFF.
As in women in horror.
Did you really find the early beers are hitting me all of a sudden? I don't know what I'm looking at.
I don't know what I'm looking at for hours and hours.
That's great, though. No, we need that. Actually, we're going to have a guest on our podcast eventually. She's young. I mean, she's young for the industry.
She's a child.
She's a super talented horror film director. She takes a lot of influences on Tim Burton and.
Well, I mean, you know, I know of some guys who host a horror podcast. If she's interested,
Stop poaching our guests. Let us get her on our
show
first.
We'll take her first. I mean, sir.
Yeah. You can get her first. We'll get her second.
We'll use her up, and then you can have her.
Yeah, we'll have the remains.
Now I'm uncomfortable.
I have no comments. I have none. Not a one on that one.
I didn't even.
But
know
I was going to
be on our shows, but that's fine.
I was going
to. Every time I try and send you guys some of our, you Corey, you fucking wait. Every time I try and send you guys a guest, you never fucking talk to him.
No, I know. We got to talk to that guy.
We're really lazy.
We're
about
not good.
I literally served you on a platter. Someone that used to draw for The Simpsons, and you can't.
Yeah, we have to. It's probably so get him on to like reach out to people.
You have to like send an email or something and be like, "Hi, we're friends with Matt."
We know we've sounded pretty jaded for the last 99% of our run, but
it's been 100% of the time.
It's reached a peak.
We want to make it clear to our listeners on your podcast that we love the physical act of podcasting. We love it. We love this.
This right now is the best
everything
part.
Everything else is like 95% of the work
at all.
We're just done. We're just over it.
And I agree.
I love podcasting except for the effort.
Yeah, exactly.
Corey shows up and his pretty face. That's all he does.
If I was getting a weekly paycheck for that shitty 95%, sure. Fine.
Yeah.
But I'm not. I'm getting a weekly paycheck for something else that's taking up all my happiness and soul.
Are you still by the elevator doors? Are you in the blast zone?
They said, you know what? It's not fair to have people sitting there. So they moved everybody but me.
So you're still by the elevator doors?
What's the Wi-Fi password?
Gonna get shot first.
I have to be there in 12 hours. I just want to kill myself.
So women in horror, huh? Oh. That's great. Our lives, unending horror.
I mean, speaking of poached guests, we had Annie and Christina on.
Don't tell them.
We know they were on.
We know.
Jack, you don't listen.
I listened to that one.
Well,
I actually didn't listen to that one. I listened to some, though.
They were all right. If you're fans of Podcast Terror, if you remember that episode, you guys covered, what movie you cover? Something recent.
Psycho.
Right?
As recent as Psycho.
you covered Psycho, and if you really liked Annie, there's a much better podcast that she was on
called 90s Percentile.
So check that out.
No,
that
90s was shit pile.
And we've been actually trying to get Christina on for a while, as she's a part of a different duo, two very funny ladies. So they're going to be one of our earlier guests, I think, this year.
Nice. And she's a filmmaker, and so she had a lot of great opinions about Psycho. So it was. She would be someone that maybe gets mentioned to look at doing this.
I guess we'll poach one of your guests that you sort of poached from us.
Yeah, we
absolutely.
Yeah, we kind of stole.
We just want.
Yeah, we should get.
It's one big. It's one big podcast circle jerk. I love it.
It's true.
They were really great guests.
You guys were great guests. We had great great 90s percentile episodes, and one okay worst episode ever.
Corey,
you son of a bitch! I took notes for that.
No, that was.
You're gonna make fun of me and pick my friends.
Were they better guests than us?
I mean, we'll see. It separately, you guys seem to do better.
I think,
yeah, you shouldn't get us in the room together. I was much better on the shitty microphone with my cats coming in.
I think this is gonna be a great episode. Just let us know when we're gonna go live.
Please just let us know when. Because it's been great catching up with you guys and talking about this horror news of the day. But you know, I think we should.
Handwriting is no longer working, Jack. You got to start doing origami.
Let's just start the
what
show.
What is this,
hey,
Prison
everybody.
Break?
Oh. That was the theme song to Prison Break, sort of.
More donut.
I really liked that show.
Oh, it's a great show. It's coming back.
Is it
going to be on soon?
Yeah.
Two seasons were great.
Third season was okay. Fourth season was garbage.
Fell off in the third season.
Was the fourth season in Mexico?
That was the third season.
That was the third season. Where is the fourth season? Right?
Fourth season was they were working for the FBI to take down the company.
Oh, yeah. The first season was great. And then I kind of got confused because I'm like, you've broke out of the prison.
There's no prison.
Right. Yeah, there's no prison break anymore.
Always tough when the name of the show no longer works.
And then they had that movie, too.
Although, worst episode ever, a Simpsons podcast, the name no longer works either. So,
why not? It still works.
Because we don't talk about the Simpsons. We just do Chicago accents.
Do whatever you want.
Yeah, we just, you know, we have fun.
Considering the Simpsons episodes themselves, you're kind of on par.
Well, which is all we need to say. Like, the writing's bad, and that's not funny.
I don't know if I ever told you, and if I did, I apologize. But in talking to Gary, who you guys still have yet to actually have on your show,
I really haven't mentioned it.
That's not the point. But that's not where I'm going with this. But he explained to me why the seventh season was so great. So what happened was,
continue.
God damn it, shut up.
Please tell us the story, man.
So all of the writers are in a room, and the producers and everyone was just kind of like, we're probably not going to have an eighth season, so take all of your best ideas and make it happen now. I fucking hate you guys so much. And
I forget that. That's amazing. That's a great story.
Yeah, and that's why the seventh season won all those awards, and then they're like, 30 seasons.
That's amazing. That's incredible.
Yeah. So that's probably why
we tell stories like that on our show. We should get this guy on.
Yeah, we should really get that guy. Not
he
Matt.
Even has an episode that he wants to do on your show.
What episode?
It's fuck. You know, just
sorry, that was my favorite.
Let's just hash it all out on here right now.
Yeah, I'm gonna send him a text
around.
We figure out the logistics right now because we haven't started recording yet, right? We're not live.
What's his email? What's he? What's when's good for him?
I'll find. We'll get to the bottom of this.
We'll wait.
Yeah, we have nothing to do. We can wait.
Feedback.
Feedback for what?
I don't know. That's what's next on our... next on our
I don't have any, because no one ever fucking gives us a 5-star rating or a nice review like they do for your shows.
I gave you a 5-star review.
You did it. We read it. Beg. I'm not going to say who you were.
We beg. We beg on our show every week.
Yeah.
So it works.
It works to an extent. I'll give you guys a review if I remember. I probably won't.
Most of our reviews are from guests that have been on the air.
That's the trick. Point.
How many reviews do you guys have?
All of them. 100 and something for worst episode ever and like 30, 40?
50? Like 40 something for 90s, like 113, I think, for Wii.
Who's counting? Ballpark.
He's counting.
It's not like I look at them every single day. 90%
miles just happen to be all 5 stars.
We have 1 3-star on this podcast, and I want to know who.
We have a ton of 1 stars for worst episode ever.
But you guys hit the front page. Oh, the episode was Simpsons Tide.
Oh,
Homer joins the Navy.
Mo, yeah, sure.
Yeah,
because I believe Gary told me that it was originally an idea.
Gary is the guy who used to work.
Gary's the guy. Yeah.
Oh, we should get him on.
Yeah, we should.
You guys have 39 5-star reviews.
Oh, don't jinx it.
On 90th percentile. I should give you a fucking 1-star. I already rated you guys.
Don't jinx it. Son of a bitch.
We love that streak. That's our...
guys, if you're listening to this and you want to rate 90th percentile, please give us a 5-star and maybe we'll let you be on
can
the show.
Can you imagine listening to 65 minutes of this without these other guys trying their hardest to do actual content in between? That's the show.
I've given up. I think Corey's still trying,
compare their show to this one, you'll automatically give them a 5-star review on theirs.
I just had a guy come up to us at Simpsons Trivia last week. I won't say who. His name's Dan Ozzie. And he came on and just said, guys, I listened to your last episode, and you took forever to get to the topic, and you talked about nothing the entire time, and I fell asleep.
Yes.
And I was like, okay, thank you.
And then he said, so when am I going to be on again?
He did.
I almost want to read this 2-star review of worst episode ever I found.
We've got some good 1-stars.
You can read a 2-star review. It's all good.
I think the guy's... Whatever. Fuck that.
It might be
this
from
guy.
Matthew Broderick because I keep mentioning he killed that girl.
We have mentioned it several times.
But the girl's family gave you a 4.
They didn't like the execution.
Yeah, the silly voices.
No, I meant they didn't like the execution.
Ooh,
yeah, the actual.
All right. I'm going to read a 1-star review from your podcast because I actually disagree with this one highly.
Okay.
Glad we're on to promote our show.
Let's do it. Well, this is the feedback section, Jack, and he doesn't have feedback for
Yeah, so we're gonna do some feedback from worst episode ever. 1 of 5 stars. Some fuck ass named Drudgery Bucket, who I hope chokes on his own vomit, says that for people who claim
his review.
What's that?
Jimi Hendrix.
This was Jimi Hendrix.
He wrote it right before he died. He traveled through time.
He traveled through time.
It was actually the time travel that killed him, like old Biff.
Wow. Wow. For people who claim to love a show, these two guys seem to know little about any episode, including ones in the era they themselves deemed the classic era. Maybe if they created an outline of what they actually thought about the episodes so they weren't constantly forgetting what they want to say and rambling on and on.
Not too
period.
Much.
Period. Could be an interesting, but execution seems poor. This person, A, has poor grammar. B, cannot construct a sentence. C, cannot create an outline for their own fucking thought. And D, should choke on a dick.
Yeah, I agree.
I agree.
Thank you, Matt.
Choke.
Yeah, I wish you could personally reply to all of our iTunes reviews. Maybe that should be a podcast.
We've tried.
Matt Stein reviews, worst episode ever reviews. Oh, Simpsons review podcast.
Just get some booze in me and let me talk to these people.
Simpsons podcast review podcast.
Yeah. Malkovich.
This other one's not even...
Malkovich.
This person seems to think that The Simpsons is still great now.
This review is not helpful.
Get a lot of those. We do get a lot of those.
We have no interest in
them. I mean, that's basically like reading the Unabomber's letters on air, Matt. Don't fucking give that person power.
Yeah.
Says the guy who wouldn't let me talk shit to the chick who called us fat hipsters.
I was totally trying to get around so you could talk shit.
Yeah, whatever. Fuck that shit, bitch.
They missed it, Jack. It's fine.
What, Jack? What'd you say? It was probably
good. Don't worry about it. Let's talk. What do we got? A movie to talk about?
No. We're not talking about the movie until Jack says what Jack was about to say.
I said you're not hipsters. We're from Brooklyn.
Try and be a hipster at all. I'm just a fat guy who wears cargo shorts and drinks beer.
What's hipstery about that? He just drinks his micro brews while riding his unicycle.
I'm actually drinking a beer from Revolution Brewing in Chicago called Fistmas.
Chicago!
Hey, we love Christmas!
Hey, Santa Claus in a barrel!
Ooh, it's good stuff here in Chi-Town! The Cubbies went all the way this year!
Obama's gonna give his last speech on the shores of Lake Michigan!
Alright, so we watched Jason
Prison Break Season 1 was shot there!
I don't even know what's happening. Was
Joliet, Illinois, I believe.
No, not Season 3, though. Maybe it was. I don't know.
Soma.
They'd already moved to Ontario.
What?
So Jason X was a movie. I don't know if you guys have heard of Jason X.
You know what's really... Well, A, Jack is wearing a Friday the 12th shirt.
He is.
I'm wearing a Kane Hodder shirt.
Hey, look at this. Yep. And Corey has a Jason shirt.
I do, but I'm wearing Darkwing Duck.
Nice.
Awesome. That was my yearbook quote in high school. Let's get dangerous. Not the quote on your shirt.
His high school quote was a picture of you wearing the shirt. It was kind of strange. Makes a lot of sense at the time.
Very, very prescient.
Dan was like, I found this picture from the future. I don't know who this guy is, but it's going to be my senior book or my senior quote.
Biggest cost of it was that it killed Biff. But that's okay.
It was worth it, though.
Totally worth it for my badass yearbook quote.
Oh, yeah.
Now he's president.
So this movie is really, really bad.
We disagree.
Jason X. It is the 10th.
So it's Jason X as in the Roman numeral X for 10.
Although chronologically, it's the 11th.
Yes. 12?
Well, no. Oh, chronologically.
If we're
talking about
the Kelvin verse, Friday the 13th?
Yeah, if you get the reboot and Freddy versus Jason in there.
Because no, Jason X was put out to... Basically, Jason versus Freddy was in development hell. And so that he said, well, we're going to do another Jason movie to keep it in the mentality of the fans and stuff. We want to keep things going. And so what they did is, even though it came out in 2002, they acted like everything happened in the first part of it, at least in 2010. Although then they kept fucking up the math and saying that it was 255 years later when it was actually 245 years later because they're Canadian. I guess there's something altered in their fucking math scale.
They're on Canadian metric time.
Yeah. Oh, gosh. Where's the hockey game? Is it at 800 o'clock again?
Jason X works because besides the X being part 10, the X also gives it that sci-fi feel. You know, like that big sci-fi movie, Marcy X.
Yeah, right. Or that sci-fi rapper, DMX.
Or that sci-fi civil rights leader, Malcolm X.
Yeah.
Or Speed Racer's friend, Racer X. That's totally not his brother. I mean, I just want to let you know, it's not actually his brother.
Wink.
It's not Matthew Fox.
Matthew Fox.
the only way you can bring him to justice is to win this race.
That was from the trailer for Speed Racer, the movie.
Get out of the way, bus driver. Matthew Fox punched the bus driver, a lady bus driver in the stomach.
What?
This is in real life. Hey, so Jason X, basically, Jason goes to space. That's the conceit of this movie. In the future, he goes to space with a bunch of friendly Canadian, nubile, young ladies, basically.
Before we talk about Jason X,
boobs,
I wanted to talk for an hour and 45 minutes about random shit.
Okay, good.
And do Chicago accents. No, I want to talk about this. We were talking about this while we were watching the movie. This whole trend of later sequels of horror franchises just randomly being in space. And we were trying to figure out what the first was. We think it's probably Critters.
Yeah, we actually did research on this.
Well,
Critters 4.
I said it without research. I did it with the whole noggin here.
It seems like it was Critters 4, Critters in Space.
But there's also Leprechaun.
Then there was Hellraiser in Space. I think it was also Hellraiser 4. Leprechaun 4, Leprechaun in Space.
A lot of fours.
Leprechaun in Space, I don't know if you guys have watched that or any of these, but Leprechaun in Space is unwatchable.
Leprechaun in Space was the first one. I watched Leprechaun in the Hood and then Leprechaun in Space.
Yeah, I think I saw Leprechaun in the Hood first. I think
in
watched
the Hood is also
too. In the Hood is a very fun movie.
No,
a lot.
I'm saying horror movie sequels in the Hood.
Yeah, Leprechaun did it twice, but yeah, and then Jason X, and then it's kind of become a punchline now.
But yeah. Critters, at least it's inherent to the storyline that there's aliens from the very beginning. It's like if they did Night of the Creeps 4 and it was in space, it would make sense because the creeps came from space.
That's actually
everything else. It's like, well, fucking let's see what happens if we throw them in space.
Right.
Also, this movie is just trying so hard to be aliens by having space marines, by having the super tough chick, which is more Ripley in Aliens 4 than Aliens itself. But they just try to make so many of the things, the parallels to that. And instead of having aliens, it's Jason and Uber Jason, which
you're right. Wow. And actually, Dan had an interesting theory because I was like, why this? Why did this in space trend happen? Does it just happen because you were doing the exact same movie over and over and you want to change the location? And Dan thinks maybe because Alien, if you think about it, is just one of these horror slasher films in space. And because Alien was so successful. I guess Aliens was super successful. I don't know what year Critters 4 was, but I'm guessing after
Critters
86.
4 was 92. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So I think Aliens was such a big hit, and everyone was like, oh, like a big space movie with this kind of action thing, you know, spin off a horror movie into an action movie by going deeper into space with space marines and all this shit.
That's the best theory we got. It still feels like it's not the best. I feel like it's just so weird that there's this, it's such a weird random trope to have for the horror genre.
It is. And it sounds like you guys maybe don't love this movie. Like, I think we really, really like this movie. And
this is my favorite Friday the 13th movie.
I snuck into a movie theater to watch this movie in high school because I was not 17 yet.
God, it's scary. Like this, me and Dan saw it. It feels like it was not that long ago.
It doesn't feel like it was 15 years ago.
And we did see it in high school. And we played our favorite game that we used to play at the time. We played the penis game.
Who's in my mouth?
similar. And we played this game where we would go to the movies because we were obnoxious teenagers.
Yes, we were horrible.
We all picked a word.
We always talked over people just didn't let them get a word in edgewise and ruined podcasts.
When we were watching...
Nice that you grew out of it.
While they're rambling, I'm going to go pee.
Chicago accents. No, the Sith are going to go all the way this year! So we played this game
Next called... Dexter Jetster is going to go all the way this year!
Go to Camino!
That's my Dexter Jetster impression.
Are you sure? That's my...
Obi-Wan Kenobi. That's good.
No, we played the penis game.
Yeah, we went to see this movie. I think we saw it on like a Sunday night. It was empty at the movie theater. There were like five other people there.
It was opening night. It was
maybe it was opening night. I don't know.
No.
The movie did not do
so
well.
Whenever we went to the movies, we assigned each other words based on the trailer that we knew would pop up. So for Die Another Day, I remember I did diamonds. You did like spy or something. And whenever they say that word on screen, you yell out penis.
Right.
And it's funny because it's a funny word and it's a thing that men have on their between the legs.
But we also got increasingly louder, right? Every time
that's the regular penis game.
Yeah. My mistake.
Although we would naturally just get louder just because we're so funny.
Right. Well, we're very funny, as you can tell. But we went to see this one, and you had machete, right?
Machete was mine, yeah.
So Jack had the word machete, and there's the scene like midway through the movie where the teacher character is alone with Jason, and he's like, what do you want? You just want your machete? Hey, guys, he just wants his machete. He just wants his machete. He says machete like 4 or 5 times. So Jack is just going, penis, penis, penis.
Yeah, it was hilarious.
It was pretty great if you are a high school-aged boy.
That happened with Diamonds in Die Another Day, too. You're supposed to pick something that's only going to show up 4 or 5 times throughout the movie.
Right.
And we overdid it, which is not something we try to do.
No, we really like to, you know, be subtle and scale it back.
We live yet? When are we starting the show?
Never. We're never actually never starting. I just wanted to hang out with you guys. So I told you we were going to have a podcast just so we could hang out.
Yeah, so that's our penis game story.
Yeah.
No, we agree. I think this is one of the most watchable Jason movies.
It's not a good movie. Say what you
will
about this movie. Yeah, I think this is a very fun, watchable movie. I hadn't seen it in a while, but I've seen it several times in the past, and I just enjoy watching it. It's just fun. It moves really, really quickly. Like, a lot of these slasher movies, especially the later installments, like, Jason Goes to Hell is fine, but there's long stretches where it's just boring as shit.
I would say
this movie is not boring.
Did you see the reboot of Friday the 13th?
Yes. I did, and I do not remember it at all because it was so boring.
I remember like parts of it was like, "Oh, this is fine." Like, I like that it went back to human-esque Jason.
Yeah,
but
that's sort of the great thing about what this movie did is it starts out when it has to jump ahead to allow for Freddy versus Jason to happen and not knowing where that's going to go. So they start out with they've captured Jason, but they don't show the capture like they did at the beginning of Jason Goes to Hell.
Well, I like the continuity there, too. They've already established the government knows that Jason keeps popping up and killing a bunch of people every few years. Like, I like the actual sense of continuity there. That's not.
I don't know about a Crystal Lake facility for like science and shit. That's weird.
Very Star Labs.
Yeah, a little odd.
And we'll get into how good they were at their jobs and shit in a second. But it does, after it finishes off, it then dumps Jason, his whatever last vestiges of him, onto the new Earth planet, the Earth 2, and gives the opportunity for it to then reset.
Yeah, they definitely left room for a sequel.
I definitely think that the reboot was supposed to be on Earth 2, and it was just unspoken. That's headcanon,
I guess.
It's
Kelvinverse.
That's what I'm saying.
I definitely think they left the door open for. But if I remember, Jason X bombed completely, and I remember even being confused about it because I was just like, I don't get it. It was a great movie.
I think it's because this is a movie made for high school boys, and as high school boys, we fucking loved it.
Yeah, there's even a surrogate nerdy white guy who I was just like, oh, that's supposed to be us. That's why he
Sooneron.
He gets the girl and he gets
a cool name too.
Spoilers, he lives and he gets the girl.
He does live.
He gets the robot. He gets the head. At that point in time, you can have a lot of fun. That's when you play the penis game.
Yeah, but the problem is that if you have the head, it does the best part, but it also talks.
Women,
he was into that. Mentally, he was into it. He wasn't interested in nipples. He was like, why do you even need...
Yeah, you don't need nipples.
I like nipples.
You're not going to mother a teen.
Nipples.
Call me old-fashioned. I want my lady to have at least one.
At least one. All right. One. No more than one, though. Let's be real here.
One to three nipples and I'm good.
All the way up to 14.
Depends where they are. If it's right in the middle of her forehead, sign me up. And like I said, nipple forehead.
I want it right on the elbow.
Wow. Now, wasn't this film basically Canadian? I mean, isn't that like the other standout about this is that Jason X was a Canadian movie?
It's like a 90s comedy.
Version.
Yeah, it was super Canadian. I mean, you could even tell, like, all of the actors had that Canadian, oh, hello, yo, what's this all about? Like, they sounded Canadian, and they were half the cast of the TV series Andromeda, right? At least the two main female actresses?
Yes. Should we talk about
Kevin Sorbo's Andromeda?
Alexa Toig, the only thing I know her from is she shows up on Arrow as Rachel Gould's daughter had the affair.
I didn't know that. I looked her up on IMDb before because I stopped watching Arrow like a season and a half ago, but that's cool. So I could see her being good.
Let's talk cast. I actually thought she wasn't terrible. This movie is ridiculous in the fact that they're casting young, early 20-something women as like genius scientists. And not that they can't be. It's not the sex that's bothering me. It's the age. Like, you wouldn't be running a facility at 23 years old unless you're some kind of prodigy.
This is the future.
But she was actually held her own. It wasn't terrible acting, as most of the supporting cast was terrible.
Yeah,
but the robot, Lisa Ryder, she actually did a great job. She was convincing as an android in like a low budget horror movie.
Yeah, I'd say Cam was like one of the best parts of the movie. But when you go down to some of the other, like the girl who played, I think it was Janessa. She wore
my favorite. She was my favorite character. She was my favorite everything in this movie. Really? She's what makes it watchable to me. Yeah, because she had all the best lines. She was just super sarcastic the whole time, and like everything that she said was the funniest parts of the film.
Really? Interesting.
I respect your opinion most of the time, Corey. Honestly, this is, me and Dan were just like, enough with this girl.
She was terrible.
It was grating.
This is the girl who had like the weird shirt that had no middle, right?
Right. Yes. Yeah. But all of them, like, that's apparently something in 400 years from now is that everybody's going to have open
on my autopsy tube top.
Well, it's so interesting because, you know, this movie's supposed to take place in like 24 or whatever, and it was actually shot in 2000, and the wardrobe and the people, they look so 2000, but just slightly updated to the future. Like, everyone's wearing tube tops and showing midriff, and like the guys are wearing those weird mesh shirts that were in for like 2 minutes, and boy bands would wear them. Yeah, it's just, I don't know, there's a very specific aesthetic that this movie has, like future 2000.
The costume design was poor, and we'll get it. Well, this is getting ahead. Another thing I wanted to talk about is I actually think the production design is probably the best part of the movie. I thought they did a good, they did a decent space movie. So, you know,
for what must be a real low budget, I think it was like 12 million.
It was 11 million. But I want to get back to the cast. The guy that played the sergeant, he's great. He's like a journeyman character actor. He was pretty solid.
You talking about Peter Mensah as Sergeant Brodsky?
I am.
All right.
So I'm talking about, he must have been in Mensah because he's a genius at character acting.
Oh boy.
Hey.
He had what I think is my favorite line in the movie when he's a sergeant. He's one of the Space Marines, and he's the last one to get quote killed, because he does come back
later.
There's
a scene where Jason takes out literally every Space Marine.
Yeah, and then there's a scene where Jason stabs him, and he says, "It's gonna take more than that to bring down this old dog." And then Jason stabs him again, and he just goes, "Yep, that'll do it."
And I remember laughing my ass off in the theater at that.
Yeah, that's legitimately funny. Like, there's a lot of funny stuff in this movie, but that's just a solid belly laugh right there.
And there's another actor who's pretty good. He brings character to it. There's an engineer who, when we were watching it with like six random dudes, some random dude a few rows in front of us just went, "It's Captain Lou Albano."
Yeah,
because
that's Crutch.
Crutch looks exactly like Captain Lou Albano. I mean, well, he doesn't look exactly. He just had a bandana and a mustache and a Chevy set. So
that's all you need to be Captain Lou.
And he played the mother in the father in Captain in the Cyndi Lauper video.
That's right.
We were having fun.
That's right.
So that's all you need.
How are you not doing a Captain Lou impersonation right now? Because that seems
like the voice. It's the Super Mario Brothers Super Show.
Shake your hips from side to side.
Oh, fuck yeah.
And in that cartoon, didn't he do the name wrong? Didn't he say Mario instead of Mario, which you guys always go on about?
Let's not get him started.
Yeah, you're right. He did say it wrong.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, everybody's wrong but us.
Captain Lou Albano, you're on my list. I know you've been dead for several years at this point.
Yeah, good enough for you ain't good enough for us. All right, Captain Lou.
Damn right.
One other one I want to bring up, speaking of Mario, the college professor, the Paul Reiser of this movie.
Yes.
He is played by the guy that was the voice actor of Link in the Legend of Zelda cartoon that aired on the Friday episodes of the Super Mario Brothers Super Show.
The excuse me guy?
Excuse me, princess! Which, if you're a Legend of Zelda fan, he's pretty much in every game. He's this stoic, quiet character. And for whatever reason in the cartoon, they just made him like this sarcastic teenage boy whose catchphrase was, "Excuse me, princess!" And yeah, that was him.
I kind of love that.
Actually, they got the hair right. He had brown hair. They got that.
That's fair.
He also did voices for Swamp Thing cartoon series. But yeah, I had no idea that was him. That's tough. That is like, there's one Zelda game that was out for like some sort of system that I think was basically like a Laserdisc player.
Oh, CDI.
Yeah, the CDI. That's the worst experience of Zelda just after that cartoon. But also Boyd Banks is in this. He plays the pilot Fat Lou, who is the guy who's like, "Oh, they found a female, hey, all right, I have to date her, I'm so lonely."
That was a great line too.
Another legitimately
we looking at
funny
each other
line.
And we're just like, oh, yeah, this sexist like dialogue is really like really bad. And then when he goes, "I'm so lonely," it's like, oh, it's like, oh, good, hey,
I like it.
And Boyd Banks, who played Fat Lou, was in the movie that we just reviewed last week. He was in Land of the Dead. He was the butcher zombie character. And he's done a lot of stuff. I mean, that guy is recognizable in a ton of different things. He was in the Dawn of Dead remake, too.
That's why he was in the Dawn of the Dead, where he's being dragged in the sewer and he's shooting people. He's not very fat, Fat Lou.
Yeah, his character was called Fat Lou in the credits, but he was not fat.
He was kind of, you know, I mean, As a fat guy, I gotta say, I was disappointed with the makeup job that they used.
Whereas there's another character, I don't remember which character this is. This the screenwriter Dallas, but that's definitely a reference to Alien.
Yeah, that's a very clear reference. To Alien.
Well, that's actually a reference to Aliens versus Predator Requiem. There's a,
where the guy is there another Dallas?
Rescue Me plays Dallas. Yeah.
Oh yeah.
And he's also the guy who decided to make the movie.
Yeah, he was the screenwriter. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We looked some stuff up too,
which is surprising because we're just like, oh, they got this bald Jack guy to play the Space Marine because right. He looks like Stone Cold Steve.
They
Austin.
They got not Stone Cold Steve Austin.
No, turns out we misjudged it. We judged a book by a cover, and we were
which
wrong.
Which is usually a proper thing to do because the book's cover tells you what the book
is
about.
They think very hard about the cover and make sure it represents right, what's inside the book.
And let's not overlook David Cronenberg's cameo at the beginning, which
that was definitely not. That
I don't
was
think
awesome.
I realized that at the time when I was watching this. As
well, you said
teenager.
It when we just watched it before. You were like, "Is that David Cronenberg?" And I was like, "No, why would David Cronenberg stoop so low as to be in Jason X?" And sure enough, it is.
Yeah.
And,
well, I recognize him tonight, but I don't think I realized who David Cronenberg was at the time.
When we saw this in theaters, definitely not.
I mean, I love The Fly, but I wasn't memorizing directors' faces yet. That was.
I recognize him mostly because of Nightbreed, because he was so good as the guy Nightbreed.
I've not seen enough David Cronenberg
movies. I saw Crash.
I've never seen Crash.
Where Holly Hunter gets into an accident and just starts squeezing her own breasts. And
right.
Fingering herself.
She gets like off on accidents, right? Mm. But The Fly, a great movie. What's the other David Cronenberg?
I like his post-horror movies.
Videodrome. That's the other one. That's
Eastern
a great
Promises
movie.
Is great.
Eastern Promises is great.
History of Violence,
History of
is,
Violence
good.
Is great. Yeah. All right. So I've seen a bunch.
Yeah, why are you lying to everybody?
Sorry,
I don't know. I don't know David Cronenberg.
I've only seen six of his movies. What an asshole Dan is.
And did you guys notice the names of the ships? Like the main ship was the Grendel, and I remember they run into the Tiamat was one of them. I was wondering if all the ships were named after fantasy style monsters. I couldn't remember some of the other ones. Like
the whole city that
there's
Jason
Solaris.
Blows up.
That's Solaris.
Oh, it was Solaris.
Yeah, that's just a naked reference
to Solaris. Solaris,
the remake with George Clooney.
I thought you meant Solaris, the tyrant son from DC Comics.
Yeah, I think that's about it. About all I got to say about the cast. The Andrew Garfield lookalike that played the
Survivor.
He did nothing for me.
Yeah,
and then the rest of the cast was just bad acting, like just bad actors. Just we're young and sexy. We'll show our boobs.
A lot of the leads were good, and a lot of the non-leads were very, very bad. Like the guy who was Asriel, who was like the most 2000 person you could have, because he was like really skinny with long hair and like sort of dreads, and he was definitely listening to System of a Down and Disturbed back in the day.
Oh, I didn't think it was System of a Down Disturbed guy.
Nothing wrong with System of a Down. Disturbed.
There's nothing wrong with them, but
I was certainly listening to them at the time.
I certainly.
Well, I mean, the commercials for this movie famously used the Drowning Pool song "Let the Bodies Hit the Floor." That was the big
fun fact. The singer from Drowning Pool, when he OD'd, it was in Milwaukee.
That is
probably because
so
he was watching Jason X.
I can't take it.
I can't believe we fucking did this movie.
That's okay. In Petaluma, we killed the guy from Sublime, but that's all right.
Oh, boy. Nothing bad has ever happened in Cowtown. No one has died in New York City.
Spalding
Gray. That's where they stopped to pee.
Spalding Gray jumped off the Staten Island Ferry to kill himself.
Is that true?
Yes.
I didn't know that.
I was there.
Jack would never lie.
He jumped, huh?
Wink.
Jack was there, wink, wink.
Let's just say.
Does anyone listening know who Spalding Gray is? I only beg.
He must have been a fan of your shows, and that's what he did. He's like,
he was our biggest fan.
Splash.
All right, so this movie starts out. They've got Jason held this facility with one guard,
and no
one guard watching him, and they're all like, "You're going to need a lot more people if you're going to take him." Oh my God, I can't believe you only brought this many. And one guard is watching him by himself in a room that apparently has multiple doors. Because he just sneaks past one when he threw a guy right through it. And there's one doctor there, which is this Rowan woman. They have a cryogenic room that when you pierce a hole in the cryogenic chamber, it automatically locks up the room. But it's open enough to then cryogenically freeze anything else that's in the room somehow.
The entire room.
Well, that's
yeah.
like if you go and get an MRI and there's like a small hole in the casing, the entire hospital lab is just bathed in strong
Oliver Geyser. Yeah, and then nobody ever comes back to this place ever.
No.
No one's ever like, where's Rowan?
I've seen this
movie. You guys see her?
I've seen this movie more times than I'd like to admit. I haven't seen it in like 10, 12 years, but back in the day, I watched it over and over.
Yeah.
I never realized that. I never thought about that. Why wouldn't anybody just go back and check in? I guess like the apocalypse happened right after that.
Oh, the Microsoft conflict maybe was going on outside the doors.
I was hoping they would explain that.
Use your imagination. It's Bill Gates Jr. had sex with
a robot?
Ivanka Trump Jr.
Started
a new galactic war.
So you're saying that the Trumps now own Apple?
That's exactly what we're saying. Apple's a great product. No. Everybody says so.
Apple's long gone by then because they tried another fucking touch.
We're calling it Trumple now. You're getting your iTrumps. Everyone's going to be great.
my iTrump 9. It has
you're
a fucking
iTrump on your iTrump. It's going
to
be excellent.
It only uses a Cyrillic keyboard. You'll have to learn Russian.
That would make sense if Apple actually did buy Twitter.
Yeah, they might.
Yeah. So and nobody comes for the army guys and the doctor who are all like, oh, we're gonna take him, we're gonna experiment him. We want him fresh. Because freezing him is a terrible way to maintain the controllable body that we'd never be able to do experiments on him if he's been frozen.
Yeah.
Why didn't they put in a program while he was frozen teaching him how to knit? That way if he was
teach him how to hack into computers, because that wouldn't be a stupid thing to teach a convict to
if
do.
Jason was hacking computers in this, that would make it such a better movie.
Okay, that's a scene that should have been in this movie.
The keyboard.
Like he's locked into the labs at some point in the future ship, and he's just like, he just like happens to be like this excellent hacker.
I know the system. Doors, windows, phones, everything.
And that's why the Microsoft Wars happened.
And that's it. There you go.
See? It's there.
Yeah, take a little work to put it all together.
Yeah, I never thought about that. Yeah, the fact that nobody would come get him. I do love the idea that they were like, yeah, we tried with the first time we executed him. That was a great line.
Yeah, definitely.
They almost didn't even need to explain that they...
But then, so where were they having him on trial? Because then they brought him back to a facility at Crystal Lake. It's like, let's just keep taking him back to fucking... We'll build the whole place right there. And...
We got this whole facility. We should just put him in this big giant room with all these doors
I was thinking about this during the movie. Would he be found guilty or wouldn't he be found insanity? Because you can't be found guilty if you can't prove that you know wrong from right. And how do you get that from this guy?
Yeah, I think his lawyer could probably if he didn't kill his lawyer, the lawyer would probably be able to convince a jury that he's insane.
Like public defender with like his tie undone.
Oh, jeez, Jason, I hope we can get insanity defense. Oh no, my hand.
Bow, 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 bow.
What's the deal? Jason goes to kill his public defender.
Yes, the judge has to cenotype us. Can you read that back to me? It says, which was not used in this at all. Like, that's another thing.
At the very, very end. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Right.
When his face mask lands on Earth 2.
I didn't like that. I wish there was, but like, it could still be a classic.
It was kind of odd. Like, I would have liked even, well, I don't know if I would have liked it, but I'm surprised there wasn't like a synthy, like, kind of futuristic, like, like something, you know.
Also, I just, yeah, you're right. It should have been like
To play with the whole
future. It should have been a Disturbed cover of.
Oh,
no.
Fuck. Just every time Jason kills someone. Oh,
I think the two original songs actually listed on the credits, one of them was called X is the Loneliest Number. I don't remember what the other one was.
Was it by DMX?
But it's got nine of them.
What? What if DMX had played Jason X?
That would have been great.
I would love to see that movie.
It would have to be Jason DMX.
Jason DMX is a movie that should absolutely be made.
Can he cross over with, wasn't it Ludacris? It was in the Halloween movie that came out.
Busta Rhymes.
Busta Rhymes, okay.
Ludacris was played the leader of the resistance in Gamer.
Oh, God. That's a
real watch. We're going to stop this.
Why is that a movie?
Right.
You're talking about Chris Ludacris Bridges?
I am.
I'm not talking about Nash Bridges. Oh, you want to talk about Nash Bridges?
I do.
All right.
On a Nash Bridges
Cheech Marin is Nash Bridges.
The guy that Sawyer killed by accident because Robert Patrick set him up.
That's right.
Was in every episode of Nash Bridges.
Just in the background. He wasn't even a character.
He played the wall. Yeah.
They should have just had Cheech play all the characters like he did in From Dusk Till Dawn.
Yeah. Oh, man.
That would have been great.
Yeah.
Jason X pussy.
Robot pussy.
We got robot ants pussy. We got regenerated arms, pussy.
I think we are on the cusp of another movie. Jason DMX starring Cheech Marin as every character.
You know what? We need to do a podcast. We'll cover Gremlins 3, Gremlins in Nazi Germany and Outer Space. We'll do Jason DMX.
In the hood.
Jason DMX in the hood.
Jason DMX in the hood.
That's racist. Work. And no, it's not. It's DMX not at all.
Black. Oh boy.
we'll paint them white.
Oh, that's racist.
That makes it better.
Literal whitewashing.
We're painting the rappers white. Off of his head. The
rappers white. I'm gonna fucking die.
You might. Somebody sees
this. DMX hears this, you will.
I'm gonna get a random phone call one day and I'm gonna be like, oh, who's this? I'm gonna answer and just be like, what?
Well, I'm just glad we're not live yet.
Yeah.
We are not live yet. Wait, are 10. We live?
Well, wait, it's 10. Sorry. Actually, it's 11. The bit is ruined.
No, it's X. You gotta remember.
It's at, yeah, when you hit 10, it's X.
X. Gonna give it to you. What else happened in this movie? There's some good stuff. All
right, so after they've been flash frozen, like Mrs. Paul's, then the students and the teachers show up. Now, you would think in a cryogenic room like this where there's not only a person frozen in a big vat, but then another frozen just randomly on the floor, that it would actually be cold enough to see their breath, and or they might have to wear more clothing than just the loose masks that they take off and the rubber gloves that they're wearing.
Star-Lord masks.
Their red raincoats are not protecting them from anything.
Not a goddamn thing. And no. It's like, oh, found random on the floor. She's perfectly preserved. Really? I don't see how that's fucking possible at all.
Yeah, she was stabbed and not in the actual cryogenic chamber, but whatever.
The science of the movie.
It's a dumb movie. That's why it's good.
It's not Interstellar.
Yeah, it's better than Interstellar.
I like Interstellar.
No, Interstellar sucked.
You should watch it again.
It's a piece of shit.
It's got problems, but it's not a bad movie.
But we do get to see that Jason kills or tries to kill even when he's not awake.
Not conscious. Yeah, because he just falls. You're talking about when he falls and he just chops that dude's arm off.
Chops the guy's arm right off and everything. And they're just like, oh, you'll be fine. Here's drugs. Oh, that is great. Thank you.
What a great future.
I like the science in the future. I like it. It's. I don't know. The movie does seem to have some kind of inner logic to it for what it's worth.
Well, I think you said this when we were watching it, that someone actually there's some thought put into the future actually, because like some things worked well.
Him getting his arm cut off is to set up the mechanical ants, like the nanobots that reconstruct your body, which is then later used in the third act to
turn Jason into Uber Jason.
I mean, it makes no sense that they would like, oh, let's this stump here on his neck. I guess this was a head. I bet it had a hockey mask on. Let me put that there too.
This is the inner monologue of the space ants.
Mechanical ants. Yeah. That's what it needed. It needed voiceover narration by Daniel Stern as the mechanical ants.
What would you do if Jason X killed you?
Would you stand up and pull up in space?
I tell you now.
Oh, Jason X is killing you.
It's just like 8mm footage of
Jason
people.
X just chopping people.
I mean, 90 that. Minutes of it just waiting to see if Kevin's going to ask out Winnie Cooper. While Paul is long dicking her. So they utilize the ants a couple of times because they utilize it on the guy's arm. They utilize it on Rowan. I think they utilize it later on for the army guy, Brodsky. Yeah. But then we just blew the fuck out of Jason. Let's leave him in the room that self-repairs everything.
Yeah, let's leave him right on the chair that will heal him.
Right, and it's the same fucking technology as if you're in the room with shit, it just automatically works. Because if you're in the room with a cryogenic chamber, then you'll get frozen too. And if you're in the room with the ants, it doesn't matter if anybody turns them on, they'll just fucking crawl out and do it.
Those things, they'll just heal you.
There should have been like a kid playing baseball outside and the baseball went through the window and turned on the machine. It's all the right keys on the keyboard.
I have to interrupt you.
Everybody shrinks and they have to get lost in the backyard.
Steven in the chat pointed out that Chappelle broke down the barriers of black people with white face, which is true.
Yeah, he did what? Who was it? What was it?
He would do the
white reporter.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Well, so maybe Dave Chappelle in white face should play Jason in Jason DMX white face in space.
So Dave Chappelle's playing DMX, playing Jason.
And he's white for some reason.
Well, and Eddie Murphy did it on Saturday Night Live years ago. The short film of him walking around.
White chicks.
Yep,
and, white chicks. Well, and then he also played the old Jewish guy in Coming to America.
Not Eddie Murphy. He's a funny guy.
So, okay. So we have Eddie Murphy in whiteface playing Dave Chappelle playing DMX and Jason DMX whiteface in space.
I can't see what can go wrong.
Yeah, this is a surefire hit that no one will be angry about on Twitter.
So if Jason X was already in space, I'm totally getting off topic. So Jason DMX whiteface should it be on Mars? Instead of in space, we have to take it like the next what's after space.
Oh, and then they get to run into Ice Cube on Mars because he's already there.
Yeah, there you go. Yes.
And that's why it's the hood.
Oh,
Black Man on a Red Planet. That's perfect.
That's a much better title. Black Man on a Red Planet. I would see that movie.
Jason DMX, Black Man on a Red Planet.
I could see the Wayans brothers making a movie called Black Man on a Red Planet, and I would probably see it.
Yeah. I'm
like the Martian, like a parody of the Martian or something. That's the movie they should make.
But the Martian was already a comedy. It won Golden Globe for best comedy.
You're right.
Wasn't it also a musical?
I'm a Martian. I'm stuck on Mars. That's gonna the science the shit out of this.
That's the theme.
That was the love theme to the Martian.
So this movie also made me question something that I never really thought about before. Jason has a real problem with people having sex. But when Jason shows up, even in like
he never got his dick wet.
Well, sure, because his mom fucked people up before he was alive and shit. But anyway, when Jason's body shows up, everybody suddenly wants to have sex. Like as soon as the body's on the ship, everybody starts banging. So does Jason give off some sort of pheromone around him that causes people to be stupid and bang?
That's an interesting theory. I think it's opposite.
I think the other way around.
I think teenagers,
right?
They're just having sex because they're teenagers is what they do. Unless you're me, when I was a teenager, I did not do that. I was watching this movie over and over
and yelling penis out
and yelling penis in the movie theater. But it's funny that he's frozen. He's thawing, but he's still frozen. And once we first start seeing people having sex,
he's waking up.
It's almost like he smells the pheromones and he's
waking up. That's exactly what happens. Yeah, people are having sex and he's just like and Janessa is twisting the professor's nipples where he's wearing the obviously straight out of the 80s, 90. But then he wakes up and now I have to kill people.
Yeah, it's like when you smell bacon in the morning and you're like, oh, it's time to get out of bed and start my day.
And you twist your nipples.
So when he smells distant sex odors, he goes, it's time for me to wake up and start my day.
Distant sex odors is a good name for a band.
Mm-hmm. It is, the DSL.
The DSL. Started.
I was going to say something and I
love that. That's how I cool the conversation by saying let's start a band called Distant Sex Odors.
Good job, Matt. God, Matt. This was, correct me if I'm wrong, Jason Goes to Hell was 93? So this was the first post-Scream Jason movie.
Yes.
So I think they were definitely having a lot of fun with the horror tropes that Scream had kind of brought to light and kind of everyone had realized by then, like don't have sex and don't do drugs and all that.
It's less competent than Scream though. Like you even said, this feels like a Skinamax movie.
Yeah, I mean, there are parts, especially in the beginning, where like the two teens, they really want to have sex when they're looking at Jason's body, and the one professor is like, okay, fine, go. And they're like, all right, thanks. There really should have been a scene of them having sex because it seemed like this was a Skinamax movie, and they just deleted all the sex scenes.
I would argue.
Except for the one with the
nipple.
They'd
make more money if they just straight up did a softcore porno with like sex scenes.
Jason XXX, obviously.
And like the non-sex scenes that you have to have in between, like to push the story forward, is just Jason killing them.
What if they made Jason XXX, but instead of it being a porno, it's just all about Vin Diesel fighting Jason?
Is that another movie?
Skateboards for no fucking reason because it's 50 years later since skateboards are cool. But fuck it, I'm Jason X. I'm gonna freaking drive down the street and Samuel Jackson's gonna come out and leak out his eye or something. I don't know which character was he in this one again. Do you think Jason has a problem with all sex, or does he have like different levels? Like if you're just giving fellatio, Jason just comes in and knocks you on the back of the head, and if you're
he's like, cut it out, asshole.
He just looks at you in the room and just shakes his head. Nah, you know, just like shame.
Well, he doesn't kill the woman that's having sex, the teenage girl. He kills the guy right in front of her, and then just walks away. He lets her live, and he actually never does kill her. She kills herself later on.
Yeah, she.
Oh yeah, when she goes through the little,
she was weepodcast.com.
There you go.
But yeah, so I don't know why he walked away and didn't kill her. She was getting eaten out. Maybe that's it. Maybe if you're the receiver, it's okay.
Well, she was in the room and the door closed and he dragged the guy out and the door closed behind. So maybe he's just like, I'll get to her later.
I'm not going to open the door twice. Jason doesn't open two doors. Well,
he didn't even open the door himself. The guy opened the door when they were supposed to go meet up with everybody. So maybe he was he didn't understand how the door worked.
It's a future door.
Yeah, because he's banging through everything else. But in that first moment of like, maybe the door is only open if you're alive.
You know what's interesting too? There's never any scene of him realizing he's like in the future or in space. Like you would think he would like look around and be like, "Where? Well, you know, like it, not talking, but just looking like confused." He just goes right for the medical machete.
Yeah, that would have been interesting. But it would have been amazing if after the ants got to Jason and he's Uber Jason. What if he, bringing this back to our last episode, all of a sudden he's super intelligent, just like Stripe in Gremlins 2, and he's just like, oh, well, here we are in outer space with a bunch of nubile teenagers. That would have been amazing. That's a completely different movie, but very good one, I think.
I'd watch. That's what we need. We need like clone Jasons. We need to just like somebody actually does get the final, like last scraps of Jason, and they just start making the army of him. That's the movie that needs to happen.
You're totally right.
That's right. They're not wearing hockey masks. They're painted on white face.
Bring it all back. I'm surprised they actually didn't do that. I mean, I wonder what the status is of doing another Jason movie, because the reboot didn't do so well.
They keep saying they're going to reboot the reboot, and they just haven't gotten around to it. There was also a TV series that was in the works about a year ago, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
CW was supposed to be doing it.
Which was not going to be a reboot of the Friday the 13th TV series from the 80s and 90s, which was just like
an anthology show. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I would kind of like to see them go back to maybe not a direct sequel to Jason X, but something in that original Jason chronology, I guess.
I don't know. Because the reboot, I guess, didn't do as well as they wanted. The reboot was like, look, we're bringing it back to the first three, four-ish Jason movies where he's just this... All right, not counting the first one. He's just this guy who's just going around killing people. It was Jason 6 that started this whole idea of this big supernatural killing machine. Yeah. And like this took it to the nth degree. I mean, the later ones, like 7, 8, 9, especially, but this one, he doesn't even have blood anymore. He just has this like black pulpy gore.
He's a force of nature at that point.
Exactly. Yeah.
Right.
He's basically.
They wound up trying to do the same thing with Michael Myers in the Halloween movies. By the time you got past 4 and 5, the 5 ends with them like there's some sort of cult of Myers, and then 6 is supposed to follow up on that. But 6 got really fucking weird.
Paul Rudd. It
did have Paul Rudd. Yeah.
Yeah, and I actually like Supernatural Jason better. Than the old, I like my favorite movies are 6 and 7 and Jason Takes Manhattan and this one. I like both models. I actually like the human, like when he starts running and chasing the teens in the reboot. But I do
the one where he fought the psychic chick.
Yeah, that's 7, the new blood with the guy from Weekend at Bernie's, Bernie.
I never saw that one.
I actually like the, like, so this Jason X is the culmination of that. Well, it's basically the Kane Hodder Jason, because, you know, he's an unstoppable force of nature. Now he's a force of technology in nature.
Yeah.
I feel like if they were to do another reboot, I think I would rather see that Supernatural. I think that's a Jason we're more comfortable with now.
The Supernatural Jason?
Yeah.
What?
The Jason reboot comes out this year.
It does.
Wait, really?
They haven't even started it yet.
No, right? It's October, I think. October 13th, which is the next Friday the 13th after... This coming Friday the 13th.
I'm surprised they never said in the movie, "Hey, it's Friday the 13th, 2400."
Whoa!
They never actually.
True.
Well, I mean, all the things about Jason that are the standards of it being Friday the 13th, about it being at an actual camp, seem to go away in this one. It's not even called Friday the 13th; it's called Jason X.
Because we already had the final Friday.
That's right. True.
Was that what Jason Goes to Hell was called? The final Friday, or am I thinking Final Nightmare?
Jason Goes to Hell.
Then it's Jason Goes to Hell : The Final Friday (a Simpsons podcast).
No, you're right. Jason Goes to Hell: The Final Friday, a Simpsons podcast.
Which, and that logo was actually a steel hockey mask, which would have made more sense for this because they don't really give him a robot hockey mask. They give him just like a weird robot face.
Yeah, it's a steel hockey mask with a snake or some sort of demon penis going through it.
Yeah, that's the Jason demon that he travels from body to body.
That was really dumb in that movie, but still is pretty. I think I've only seen that movie like twice.
This was a horrible movie. I sat through it twice.
I had to watch it again just to make sure I hated it.
It is
Wilma Deering in it, so rock on.
It's Jason Goes to Hell the Final Friday.
I know. I said that like 5 minutes ago.
Hey.
Welcome to the podcast. At least we're not recording.
Are we
recording?
Thank God. Because this is terrible. I wouldn't release this if I were you guys.
Hi, guys.
So one of the things that I was thinking about while watching this is what they do with KM, which is the robot character, is they upgrade her a la The Matrix.
He doesn't actually say I upgraded her. He says I uploaded her.
Exactly. Her. We all know what you meant, buddy. All right, we get it.
Exactly. We know you're uploading
screenwriter
a robot.
Gotta get that robot technology down.
But
I made a better.
When she's fighting him, I thought this got to be straight up they're ripping off Resident Evil.
Yes.
But Resident Evil hadn't come out yet.
Yeah, it hadn't come out yet. There was definitely a Resident Evil vibe to it,
I mean, the first
absolutely.
Not when they filmed this, because they filmed this in like 2000, I think.
They were ahead of their time.
The
they were. Although I was like, why do you keep getting, I know you're a robot, but stop getting up close. You have all these guns. Stop getting within machete distance of him.
Yeah. But that's a badass scene when she fights Jason. I thought that was awesome. You know,
it feels like the end of the movie too. So basically, he goes and kills all these teenagers, and there's a few left. And
I think that's why the movie doesn't feel like it lags in any place, because they basically do the full Friday the 13th movie in the first hour, and then the last half hour is when you get the Uber Jason piece, and it's just like now you fought regular Jason, but now try Cyborg Monster Jason.
Next level.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah, and I guess the thing with KM is that she's a little bit Bishop, and she is like Ripley in Alien Covenant, which is when she got super tough because she had Alien.
Alien Resurrection. Alien Covenant hasn't come out yet, and it's
That's right. Alien Covenant's the new one.
Yeah. Although the captain in Alien Covenant, Danny McBride, I'm pretty sure they modeled his look on Fat Lou from Jason X. I'm just a word.
Not Fat Lou. The other guy.
Pilot. What?
The engineer that survived for a while.
They both have a cowboy. Like Danny Pryde has like a cowboy hat in the Alien.
Oh, that makes sense.
That's about right.
That's what I meant. The cowboy hat.
Okay.
That's all. I guess he has a mustache. I don't know.
I never saw Alien Resurrection. I'm just throwing that out there.
It's a good movie. It's not. It's the worst.
I own
of the
it.
Four.
I own it on Blu-ray. I have the Alien.
It's
quadrilogy.
It's competent.
I mean, it's Joss Whedon wrote for it, and it's got Hellboy in it. It's almost like his first try at doing something like Firefly.
That's interesting.
It's not a great alien movie, but it's a great 90s sci-fi space movie.
All right, I gotta watch it.
God damn it.
They utilized Ripley for, and it seems kind of like what they did with River by the time they got to Serenity.
Gotcha. Yeah. Okay. That's a glowing endorsement.
I don't know what this is about Serenity. Me. I actually thought Sigourney Weaver was at her most attractive in Alien Resurrection.
Okay.
And Winona Ryder was not.
You guys ready to start recording?
You want to talk about
are we starting? Hey, everybody, this is Podcast of Terror coming at you live from Chicago, and a Cubs just took it all the way to the World Series, and deep dish pizza is prevalent.
Oh, fuck, I love pizza so much.
Pizza is the best.
Yeah.
Pizza on a bagel means you can have pizza anytime.
There you go. Went to the same place.
Yeah.
they make nachos, self-contained nachos now.
Self-contained nachos? Explain yourself, Matthew.
So like stuffed nachos?
So it's like a stuffed nacho. I'm trying to, it's like nacho.
But nachos are a thin chip.
Yeah. So it's like a chip, and then inside, and then another chip on top, and then you bake them, and then you burn the inside of your mouth eating them.
That sounds about right.
Yeah.
Because what is life without pain and nacho sauce?
I still don't have taste buds on my tongue because I ate some yesterday.
Oh, boy. Oh, boy. I'll look into eating those.
They're Totino's Nacho Bites.
Totino's Nacho Bites.
Send me your pizza rolls.
Oh, boy. We make ourselves laugh.
No one else does, so we might as well.
It's true.
What
else do you guys want to talk about with this movie? I don't know. I don't know if we have much.
My favorite part has got to be the use of the virtual reality.
Oh, yeah. How did we not even talk about this yet? Yeah.
Well, I literally said before Matt started rambling about nachos, we should talk about the virtual reality.
I didn't even hear you.
Let's calm it down.
That was set up earlier on because we see the weird stoner kid and the actual screenwriter of the movie playing in this virtual holodeck type thing, and Jason comes in. And it's actually really funny because Jason kills the monster they're fighting, and then he kills their avatars and is like, why didn't they die? I'm Jason. I'm confused. And it's this whole VR holodeck type thing.
Which means Jason can be fooled by things that require perception, which kind of goes against the Jason being the force of nature thing. He's still got human reactionary thought processes when it should just be like, I just instinctually know where people are fucking, so I have to go kill them now. That's kind of his whole
point. Yeah, because like, yeah, either the pheromone theory or when the entire spaceship explodes, he somehow is just propelled towards them. And that makes sense if it's this just otherworldly, he's just literally being propelled towards more victims. The virtual reality, see, I guess that is that moment I was looking for earlier where he's just like, what's, I'm confused. What's going on?
Yeah. I think the worst mutant power would be, I know where everyone is fucking at all times.
It's always not here.
Professor, you're right. Professor X does have that power already.
He's a cerebrone.
Cerebone.
Boy,
sometimes he's pissed off at Gene, so he just makes it. Scott's O face just makes his eyes pop, and all of a sudden he shoots her in the face.
Oh boy,
with the eye beams. I mean, don't get gross, kids.
Hey now,
look up cable porn online.
Enjoy it.
Don't do it. Just look up our podcast about it.
Just listen to us react. You don't want to actually see it.
About the VR, you know, the science in this movie isn't supposed to be sound or anything because it's mechanical ants that bring Jason to life. But the VR, it's basically you put these goggles on and you sit down and face each other, kind of like when you're having sex and you're doing the hunka bunka in Demolition Man. And
Barbarella.
And so it's not exactly a image chamber holodeck from Star Trek. It's more you're in these goggles, but Jason seems to be in a holodeck.
Yeah, it's kind of.
He's not wearing the goggles.
It's a little.
Your VR technology. Is this a PSVR or a HTC Vive?
Get your shit together, babe.
I would guess that. If I'm gonna think this through, God the fuck, why am I doing this? If you're having this VR game, and then so the two players are there, and they can sit and play the game, and it doesn't matter what else is going around the room. But if you want to have it be witnessed by other people, like you want to have the group of friends who get to watch you play the PS2 games, then so it's projected around the room for everybody else.
But he can participate because he cuts the monster in half.
But yeah,
the
machete. He's right, killing things in the game.
So why would?
Yeah, that's weird.
Doesn't
I'm starting
add
to
up.
Think this movie wasn't fully thought out.
This movie about mechanical ants solving, restoring a force of nature is not so logical.
But this whole VRS, this is what I'm saying. The production design in this movie is actually like, it's really hard to do a space movie these days and have it look different from everything else. You know, every space movie looks exactly the same. Creatures look the same. Spaceships look the same. It's very hard to have a distinctive style. And like the Space Marine guns I thought were really cool. The spaceships themselves look cool. I hadn't seen stuff like that. I love the idea that they're on a giant literal pontoon and they call it a pontoon. I haven't seen that really.
It's weird because I think this whole world is pretty well fleshed out.
The production designer was really bringing his A game.
You know, VR quibbles aside, everything looks really cool. There's a unique kind of aesthetic to this movie.
There are also things that are so like not high tech enough to actually make sense. Like, oh, the ship is flying towards the space station and it just goes ramming through and destroys like
there's literally nothing to stop it.
Blows up. It's like we had no plan if this ever happened. Any kind of space debris. It's not like we have Bruce Willis to launch in the fucking atmosphere.
That's actually a great point. They have no defense. And I guess in this movie, Jason kills thousands of people.
Yeah. The biggest body count for old Jay.
Let the bodies float in space.
Was their follow-up. It was not as big a hit.
I'm going to OD now. My space theme sequel song didn't work.
Anyway.
But the moment when they use the virtual reality to distract him when he's starting to walk into the room and they're like, well, let's try to set up something that he'll be into for a second. So they camp Crystal Lake or an equivalent of it. And it's like, okay, there he is. Oh, he doesn't give a shit because there's nobody to kill there, so he's still going to come towards us. So they make fake camper girls who are like, let's do drugs and have premarital sex. And
I love that line. Yeah. It's so meta.
it was so perfect to the 80s nostalgia of what the film started with, and it made perfect sense of like this is his reason for being.
That's my favorite.
What he's always hated.
I love that it's referencing the, you know, you still have a scene that's at Camp Crystal Lake, even though it's this weird future space movie, and they cut away. And then they just suddenly cut back, and he's literally beating one girl in her sleeping bag to death with the other girl in her sleeping bag.
Yep.
And then when he's done, he just bashes her against a tree.
Yeah, which is a little brutal.
But you have the movie's most obvious nudity. It was just like the perfect movie in a nutshell right there.
Yeah, definitely. It was
give the audience what they want moment.
Exactly. And I like that they were just like, oh, we need a distraction for Jason. Quick, let's pull up the Camp Crystal Lake circa 1980 file that we have on this spaceship for some reason.
That's on the demo disc.
Yeah. And also they were like, we need people for him to kill to distract him. And they make only two campers. And it's like, he killed him. He's still coming. Make more people.
Right.
Again.
Put like a brick wall there so he doesn't try walking through it.
Yeah, we mentioned this when we were watching it. Like, it would have been funny and cool if there was suddenly an army of campers that Jason's just hacking his way through. It would have been awesome.
CGI Kevin Bacon.
Now that would be great.
Get the guys that did cartoon Grand Moff Tarkin and just do a cartoon Kevin Bacon.
Let's CGI him now in the special edition version.
I don't know if we want to have an army of campers if all of a sudden Jared from Subway shows up, but I do think what you're right is that there were more things they could have thrown in there. They just kind of like gave up, but I guess it was also budgetary restraint because they were planning on having like, they were going to distract him by using a virtual reality version of his mom. They were going to do more things with it. Yeah.
That would have been awesome. Yeah. That would have totally fucked with him.
That would have been awesome. But then I like that they saved the mom until Freddy vs. Jason. Because that's what Freddy uses to get him to kill all the people.
I mean, the mom shows up in every other couple of movies.
Yes, Jack. I haven't seen
all of
them.
There's not a lot of Jason mythology you can use. You got the machete. You got the hockey.
And they utilize it in the remake, too, but not by having the actual mom there, by having one of the characters look enough like the mom to be able to manipulate him, which is similar to what they did in the fourth one, where they had Corey Feldman play him as a young version of himself. He shaves his head. And it's like, oh, you think I'm you now? Because
I'm looking bald
and ugly as shit.
But your voice sounds like Donatello from Ninja Turtles 1 and 3.
Hey, Mikey. Want to order pizza?
What are we up to, G? Gack face.
And here's where I do my Jason rap on ABC.
Jason, rap. ///. All right, I got nothing.
That's what he needs to do. He needs to have his Corey's Angels dress up like little campers behind him.
He'd get Jared Fogle's money.
Oh, oh, boy. I don't know if we have anything else to say about this movie. Oh, I don't know if you guys do.
I got some notes here.
Let's keep talking. Keep podcasting.
Oh, I
going.
Like that the opening credits are in hell. That was a cool looking thing.
That was cool.
In the nascent days of CGI.
Yes, it looked like Spawn, like that kind of CGI hell.
Which was still trying to tie into Jason Goes to Hell leading into this one because they weren't sure if Freddy versus Jason was ever going to happen.
Also, I might be reading into this, but the hell is actually in his eyes. It's like, he's
in
not
your eyes.
He's not coming from hell. Song.
Jason's outside the camp holding up a radio.
Now that I'd watch.
Now that I would definitely watch.
The light, the heat this in was your the, eyes. This was the final Kane Hodder movie.
Yeah, it was.
Kane Hodder played Jason. He played, like I said, the big supernatural Jason. He was fired from Freddy vs. Jason because the director said his eyes weren't human enough. He wanted a more sympathetic Jason, which makes sense if you watch the movie.
Well,
but Kane Hodder was very vocal. He's like, this is bullshit. I'm Jason.
Yeah.
Yeah. As he should have been.
What was he?
Have a man.
Oh, he wrote and directed or produced and came up with the idea of a Expendables type movie of horror.
Yes, Death House. It's coming out this year.
Well, you were telling me about it.
Yeah, you told me. Yeah. I want to watch that.
I'm just rehashing stuff you told us on a previous episode of the podcast. Here, have one of our guests. Thank you.
Hello.
It's a trade-off, yeah.
Can I be on the podcast of terror?
Bring me Freet and I'll give you ideas.
I'm a frequent guest of worst episode ever.
You guys can cut that out if you want.
Nope.
Jack usually does.
I cut nothing.
Is that it for your little notes?
I was going to say, guess Jack. You're not Jewish, but I'll leave it alone.
Oh, boy.
I won't make the joke.
You didn't leave it alone. You said the joke.
Because like they cut the skin off
their
penises.
Their wee-wees.
Choose your machete.
saved enough foreskin to make 12 new boys.
Oh, jeez.
Oh, boy.
That's an Arrested Development season one joke.
So three of us agree that this is a perfectly fun movie. If you're going to do something new and off kilter from the other Friday the 13th movies, that this was a good way to go. So why is it so universally panned?
Did people have this idea that the Friday the 13th movies were good and this was a drop off? And did they not see the final Friday?
Yeah, I don't. I mean,
they didn't because the movie bombed, and that's why it took 10 years to make another one.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I think a lot of horror fans tend to not like these later installment ones where it goes for more like a horror comedy kind of vibe. They want like the people getting killed and just like to be jump scared and things like
this
that.
This has better kills than most movies.
I mean, it has great kill. So, just, you know. Yeah. Kills 10 Marines in a row and
he bashes a girl's face in. Yeah, carbon, liquid
nitroglycerin,
liquid nitrogen.
Yeah, what Jack said.
Yeah, maybe it's just because it's so easy to poke fun at it. If I tell you on paper, oh, we're making a robot Jason, it sounds stupid.
It does. It's Jason in space. You know, that's an easy punchline. But I, you know, I think a lot of people maybe didn't really watch it or film critics, you know.
They're
not going to be like, I loved Jason in space. This
isn't a Godfather Part 2.
It's not. Why am I even watching this?
But that's the question is, like, they constantly want them to come out with new Friday the 13th movies, and then they're just constantly complain. Well, this is a bunch of shit. It's like, but that's what the Friday the 13th movies have always been.
Not a good Friday the 13th. Nobody was like, saw Friday the 13th Part 5 and was just like, yeah, they got it right. Give it an Oscar. we're gonna open it up for more nominees because this movie got the short shrift.
Or maybe it's just that people want to see the same movie over again but slightly different, which is what a lot of like the early sequels are in a lot
but
of
but if that's the case then the remake would have done better too.
Yeah, that's true. Well, the remake, I think it was probably, you know, because the remake and a lot of horror movies in general are aimed at like teenagers, and teenagers in 2009 or whenever the remake came out, they don't give a shit about Jason. They don't care about Friday the 13th. Like, we're the people who would care about that. And I didn't give a shit when it came out because it looked like it was a piece of crap.
I think it's because this was the first post 9/11 Friday the 13th movie. And it was just people were still, you know, our heroes fell. I think it's
true.
Nobody wanted to see a bad guy killing innocent people when we just saw the ultimate Uber Jason, Osama bin Laden, kill, you know, he threw a spaceship into a space station, the World Trade Center.
It's very true.
And took out a bunch of people.
What people didn't know was that Jason X was the movie that could have healed our hearts with its use of mechanical ants.
Yeah. That's what we need. We need a Pixar Friday the 13th.
That would be great. Like a sequel to, or DreamWorks, a sequel to Ants, but about the mechanical ants. And they're just, you know, there's like this one little mechanical ant. He's like, I'm not good at my job.
I guess I'm going to have to heal Jason now.
Hey, Woody Allen, what are you doing here in space with me, Sylvester Stallone?
I think you should give him a hockey mask.
Give Machete's life. No, it should be all the murder weapons from all the various horror films all get together and they're in a room. They're in like somebody's backyard and like, well, we need to go next door and kill Billy. Yeah, but I have my own feelings too.
There's like the one sad pin that's in Pinhead. He's like, I'm in his boogers.
I thought I was going to make another Hellraiser
movie. I just want to work as an acupuncture needle.
We need to make our own Hellraiser movie. Just have a scene where Pinhead blows his nose and it's just like a pin, like, no, I want to be part of the movie.
He just pulls a hammer out and tries stamping it back in. Like a fucking street level magician. Or David Blaine, who can probably do that pretty easy now. Oh,
he shot himself in the face and I laughed.
He did.
There was no sympathy, I think, at all for him.
I think he faked. I think it's a stunt.
Well, it's definitely a stunt, but I think he really did shoot between his teeth.
I think the act that it went wrong, quote unquote, is part of the stunt. I think.
Well, that you could be right there. But anyway,
I met his brother once at a party. Biggest douchebag I've ever met in my life.
Really?
Yeah, Rich Blaine.
He sounds like a douchebag.
I don't remember his name was Rich Blaine. Right? All right. But the fact that he was literally within 5 minutes of meeting him, he was just like, "Yeah, David Blaine's my brother." That was the first warning sign.
All right. Is this the David Blaine podcast? Talking Blaine?
Yeah, I mean, he comes out here and he wears white face and
It's certainly an endurance trial for people to listen to us. you think hanging out in a glass box cube over the Thames is hard?
Yeah, right.
Try listening to 93 episodes.
Listen to all of our podcasts.
That's what David Blaine's next stunt should be. He just listens to all of our stuff ever.
He'd be driven mad within minutes.
Just why is the bottom of the box filled up with blood and it's coming from his ears?
Oh, boy.
And whatever. Yeah, I can't really think of much else to say about this movie. I love it. I get why people don't love it, but I feel like those people, there's nothing that you can give them in a current Friday the 13th that they're going to love.
Yeah.
And we keep trying to go back to the well and like reinvent what already existed. I think people get more excited by horror movies that are new. We just watched the new Blair Witch a week or so ago. And it did some new things, but it's still Blair Witch. And I just don't know that it's going to be a success to keep trying to go back to that at this point.
It bombed, right?
I don't think it did great.
I don't think so.
It didn't do great. I haven't seen it yet, but I had heard great things about it before it came out. And the reviews when it came out were just like,
and I liked it.
I was super excited to go see it. And then the reviews were so bad. I was just like, oh, I guess I can wait. And I still haven't watched it.
I know nothing.
It's fine. It's perfectly fine. It's a decent take on the idea of a Blair Witch film. Certainly closer to the original than Book of Shadows was. But I kind of like Book of Shadows because it was different.
Book of Shadows is an awful, awful movie. But you're totally right. Like, it's kind of this fun, awful. And yeah, it's way different than the, you know, it's not found footage at all. It doesn't make any sense like the first movie does. Yeah.
Do you think we'll ever see Uber Jason, which is what the technical name of the robot Jason is? Do you think we'll ever see him again in any form? Is that it? Like even Zilla, even the awful Godzilla remake from with the movie where the guy killed a girl while he's driving and fell asleep.
Yeah, Matthew Broderick.
Even he returned in some more Godzilla sequels as like a new side character. Like I was telling Dan when we watched it, I was like, I'm surprised there's not like a Marvel Friday the 13th comic or something, and with like a broader mythology where you can really experiment with the tone and broaden it up a bit, and you can have like an Uber Jason that, you know, maybe he's from the future and he visits like a future Spider-Man or whatever.
There have been comic series. I don't know if there's any that are currently ongoing. I feel like Uber Jason may have shown up in one of those, and if he hasn't, he probably should.
I think that's the movies might not be the best medium for him.
But he should have at least put his skin in like one of the fighting games that he showed up in.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Or maybe in the new Friday the 13th game, if there's somehow I doubt it. If there's somehow an Uber Jason reference in something in that new Friday the 13th game, that would be great.
I mean, that should be downloadable content for that game.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because definitely. What a great thing is you get a new map because you put them in the spaceship, which is a tunnel style map, which is fantastic for that kind of like close quarters feeling of suspense, which Aliens introduced and works well with. And then you have Uber Jason. You give the chance to like play against this character or play that character.
Make it a fucking VR game. Make it for PSVR. Yeah. That would be amazing. You're in the VR simulation on the Grundle.
The Grundle. Oh boy.
Yeah, it's a thing under your.
I know what it is.
Next to the Gooch.
The Gooch. The taint.
I think the Grundle is
fleshy fun patch.
Subway sandwich, isn't it?
Oh boy, it's sandwiched between two things.
Hey now, all right. Do you guys rate things? Right? Is it time to rate?
Is it time to start? Are we live yet?
Yeah, we should start recording.
Yeah, let's actually start recording, and then we'll just go straight to the rating.
I'm gonna write a 15 ahead of time, assuming we're gonna really just run.
It's gonna happen. But yeah, we've adapted the new FAP scale.
FAP scale, I love it.
Yep, we do it on 0 to 5 on the feature, the attention, and the panic. We start with the feature, which is the movie itself. What did you think of the movie itself on a 0 to 5? We'll start with Dan because he's on the right.
So this is just like
very
my
very conservative.
You know what?
American. Yeah, I was going to say Jack's on the alt right, so that makes sense.
Oh dear.
Oh boy.
I love the Nazis.
Oh no! Oh, you can't go through a guest appearance without bringing up the Nazis, can you?
It's a long story. If you're a new listener, I don't actually like.
No,
the
no.
Yeah. Also, he doesn't believe they existed.
Well, but just, not Jesus.
Just overall,
I would probably give this movie a 4 out of 5. I think it's a lot of fun. I enjoy watching it for all the reasons.
Do you do point fives?
Yep.
I know that. I would listen to the show. 3.5 out of 5. 4. I could go 4. It's very
fun. We just watched it. I would be happy to watch this movie again.
I've watched it dozens of times. It's very enjoyable. But it's still a bad movie.
Well, I mean, feature is the story aspect of it, right?
I don't even know anymore.
Yeah, you took out the helpfulness, because we're going to talk about the attention of how well it held your attention next.
I don't even fucking know.
And then we'll talk about scariness. So yeah,
to Corey. Don't listen to me.
If you like the story of the film, that's what we're going for right here. Do you think the story was interesting?
I do like the story of the film. I'm going to stick with my 4.
3.5 is a good score. That's like a B+.
Yep. Fuck yeah.
3.5.
It's good.
What about you guys?
Yeah, Corey, what do you say, you son of a bitch?
I can't imagine what could have been done with Friday the 13th at this point that hadn't already been done to death. And I think this was a smart thing to do, to try to have a placeholder film while they were trying to figure out what to do with Freddy versus Jason, which was obviously a far more commercially successful film and was always going to be. That's what people were waiting for. And I think that this film gets pissed on because it was a placeholder. I think it's fun. I think it was written well. I think the characters were funny. And so, yeah, I'm going to go 4.
Good man.
Because I'm more Team Jack than I am Team Dan, I'm going with a 3.5 out of 5.
I'm burned, Matt. Personally, I'm very offended.
I'm not that offended.
I know you aren't.
You're bad things.
You're cold-blooded. The next one we have is the attention. How essentially it's a rewatchability. How likely are you to rewatch this movie?
What was this category again?
Attention. I had to go with the FAP, so I went with an A, which is an attention. It's just rewatchability. Yeah,
the joke.
Was your dick standing at attention during watching of this film?
It's good that it's short. It moves quick. Although there was a.
Are we talking about your penis?
Oh boy,
we are. It was good that it's short, because that car would have took it right off.
Oh man.
And I was just inches from the curb.
Oh.
I actually was getting bored, I think, when the spaceship was like blowing up. The very final scene, I was just like, I was losing. But 90 minutes, it's lean. Like I said, I like the fact that it's a Friday the 13th movie in a nutshell in the first hour, and then you got the robot as the third act. I thought it held my attention very well. 4.
I'm going to flip-flop a little bit here, and I'm going to go 3.5, basically for the same reasons Jack just said, but he's right. At the very end, it starts to lose me a little bit. It's a tight 90 minutes. The rest of it moves by. But by the time you get to Uber Jason, I feel like they don't do enough with Uber Jason.
He doesn't kill. Uber Jason never kills anybody.
Like, you kind of want to see, like, you have robot cyborg Jason, and he's just bigger and tougher than regular Jason. Like, there's no cool robot thing he does, yeah, which would be cool.
He literally never kills anybody. The 3 deaths that happen after he becomes a robot, the guy blows himself up.
Yeah.
The girl is indirectly
sucked through the wall, and
the sergeant burns up in the atmosphere with him.
Yeah.
You never see Uber Jason robot punch or eye laser or machete, whatever.
He kills the fictional campers. That's the only way you get from him. Which is one of the best kills in the film, easily.
Yeah, definitely.
Probably
definitely,
the best.
Definitely. Yeah, so I'll stick with 3.5.
Corey? Well, no, Corey.
I enjoyed watching the movie again. This is the one Friday the 13th movie that if it's on, I'll stop and watch, because it's fun, it's enjoyable. So it held my attention because I think that there are character moments that make it worthwhile, more than just being a boring guy hacking up teenagers again film. So I'm going to say 4.
Definitely.
I just realized it's the exact same thing as Jason Takes Manhattan, where the whole movie is about him being in New York, and then that's the last 15 minutes of the movie, just like him being a robot.
Yeah, but at least the first hour of this movie are good.
First hour Jason Takes Manhattan, but he's on a boat.
It's not great.
He's on a boat, motherfucker.
It's as real as it gets.
I have a 3.5. I think it's a really... It's a fun movie. It's easy to rewatch, and there's not a whole lot to it. You don't have to pay attention for shit.
Yeah.
Wasn't Jason Takes Manhattan also about a bunch of students?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was.
That's right, yeah, on a field trip.
Yep.
Which is basically what this was, right?
Yeah. They might have been on a. I think they were on a field trip. They might have been on a.
Just a future field trip.
Graduation cruise.
So not a lot of originality in this movie at all. It's not trying to be original. It's trying to just repackage the things that have been successful in other parts.
The one scene I would say that was different was him. There's a scene where he just takes out all the Space Marines. You don't really get that in a... Usually it's just camper after camper or teen after teen after teen. There's not usually a scene where the cops are wise to him and they show up and he takes them out one at a time.
Right, we've never seen Jason fight an army.
Because when the army comes after him at the beginning of Jason Goes to Hell,
they
actually succeed.
Yeah. So I like that.
Yeah.
That was original.
Sweet.
I agree.
The last one we got is Panic. It's the scariness. 0 to 5. We'll start with one of you two jackoffs. Do whatever you want.
I mean, it's not an especially scary movie. I mean, this is definitely a horror comedy, which makes sense when you're doing the 10th movie in an installment. You know, you can't have the same level of scares. So, I don't know, a 1?
Go with the level of kills. Go with the level of, like, how the kills kind of bring it out. Because, We know we're desensitized to horror movies on this show, so we don't get scared, but there may be something about the way that it presents. And in a lot of cases, it's like, do you buy into it, or is there something original to it, or is it just like graphically cool to look at?
If that's kind of our metric here, I'm probably going to go back up to a 4 then, because I think a lot of the kills are great, and we spent a whole lot of time talking about the look of the movie and how much we like it. So
the
look,
the feel of Jason.
I think I might have to bump my attention down to 3.5. I purposely inflated those a little bit because I was going to give this like a 0. Because I wasn't scared at all. Compared, you know, they're genuinely terrifying, the earlier ones. As a kid, I actually used to have Jason nightmares. Whereas this one is, there was zero terror, but the kills were great. He smashes a face in, there's a corkscrew death. Most of the deaths were actually rather inventive. And there's a lot of gore. You watch the autopsy of Jason and she like peels the mask off his face.
She pulls the eye out of the socket. Yeah. That's awesome.
Man, she's a freaky girl, huh?
She was real freaky
woman.
And her kill was actually one of the more interesting ones because he shoves her face in the liquid nitrogen and freezes immediately.
There's a sink.
He probably didn't care. He probably just thought he'd drown her, but as soon as he stuck her face in there and she stopped struggling, he picks it up, looks at it, and then smashes it. Like the extra moment of like, oh, it's not enough that she's dead. I'm going to now smash her frozen face so it just shatters everywhere. That was
a great
kill. Intense.
He wants to get he doesn't fuck
around.
He's
lucky he didn't put his hand in too deep, and maybe they should have used that liquid nitrogen to take out Jason. Freezing him,
they could have refrozen him like he started, instead of knocking him into a planet, which was also somewhat effective.
Which also, they just happened to like land on Earth 2. I thought they were in the middle of space.
Yeah, I don't know.
And is it the same Earth 2 from the NBC show?
I assumed yes.
That's why it's just floating around there, nowhere.
Clancy Brown around on the rover.
Now, I may back down on the scores because, Jack, you pointed out the fact that the last 3 people who died had nothing to do with him. And that's kind of the thing, is it sort of becomes a farce at one point where more people are dying because of their own stupidity than by what he's doing. And I remember in the early 80s, there was a horror movie where a killer's going around and trying to kill people, and they keep dying in front of him. And he's just like pissed off. He's like, God damn it. And he goes walking to the next room. And I think in that case, even though the kills were cool, I can't give a lot of credit for the fact that it's a lot of it is because people strictly are panicking. So I'll go through.
So, but you're ranking the movie. You're not ranking Jason as a killer, right?
Right. Absolutely.
Are you still getting something out of the kill? Like the girl going through the grate should have been cool. They actually cut away, which
they
I thought
cut
was
a lot of it. I feel like they must have had to. Like maybe there's an unedited cut somewhere.
They didn't cut out an Alien Resurrection. The spoilers: the alien at the end dies that way, and they show it in full detail. And
I gotta watch Alien. Yeah. Whatever you just said. What's it called? Resurrection. The fourth one.
It's about Jesus.
Oh, I gotta watch it. Because I love Jesus.
It takes place 3 days after the first Alien.
Happy Easter. That's my Chicago Zeno.
I mean, when you think about it, it is sort of an Easter effect. It's going around laying eggs everywhere and hiding them, and
oh man,
it comes back to life. It's weird. Now I think about it, the fucking Alien Easter movie. That's what we're missing. It's the religious alien film.
They gotta stop doing Christmas in space sequels. They need to do more Easter sequels.
Yeah, let's do it.
Yeah. I mean, if anything's calling for a comeback, it's Easter.
Easter's
Freddy Krueger just like kills. He's like, "Where's my peeps?"
That's something Freddy would say.
I make jokes. The bats are gonna go.
It's true. They are gonna go all the way this year. Freddie's a big Mets fan. All right,
Matt, your score.
The Mets are from Queens, not Chicago, right?
I think I know something about the Mets, Jack. They're gonna go all the way this year. I've heard tell.
Four. I give it a four.
Did I give it a number?
Yeah, he said like 3.5 or something stupid.
Yeah, that's what I have down. Corey, did you give it a number?
I did. I gave it a 3 for
okay. I'm giving it a 3. I never gave it 3.5. I don't know where that came from.
You mentioned it.
I didn't. I'm giving it a 3.
By the way, the movie I was thinking of was called Student Bodies from 1981.
I've heard of that movie. I have never seen it, and it sounds awesome if that's what it's about.
The killer is called The Breather.
Ooh.
Hmm.
I breathe.
Was it played by James Gandolfini?
It's just like a guy. He's not even trying to kill people. He's just been eating pork chops and cheesecake all week.
My gobble goal.
There's nothing wrong with
Carmella.
Nothing wrong with cheesecake.
Oh boy.
No, not a goddamn thing of it. It's actually it was a night this week that's what I had was pork chops and cheesecake, and I felt great for 5 minutes after my heart started beating again.
Pork chops and cheesecake. God damn it.
All right. That's it. That's the show.
All right.
Corey, read the stuff. I don't want to.
All right. You can contact us by going to amazon.wepodcast.com. Oh, no. I mean, you can contact us by leaving us a voicemail at 805-328-3966. Email us at pot@gncast.com or leave us a message on the website. And if you want to, you can go to gncast.com/subscribe. And find the places where you can get a subscription to the show. You can go to iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, and leave us a review. We're gonna now start begging. We're gonna work it out so maybe we can get some, even if they're the terrible reviews that We Podcast gets. Or
you can take some of ours.
We'll take the 5 stars that 90th percentile gets and deserves that show.
If you're listening to this show, if you're a new listener and you're listening because we're going to probably link the hell out of this on our stuff, and you're a We Studios fan and you're checking out Podcast Terror for the first time because you didn't check out our YouTube channel where we actually have previous episodes of Podcast Terror on there, you should definitely leave them a review. You're generous to us. You should be generous to them.
We would appreciate it, but you guys are generous with your time most of all, and that's what's most important to us. You can also follow the show on Twitter and Instagram at Podcast of Terror. And you guys, where can we find you? Amazon.wepodcast.com.
You can definitely go to amazon.wepodcast.com. That'll take you at amazon.com.
Yeah, you can shop through. It's literally the exact same thing as buying on Amazon, except we get a cut.
And we get a cut. But wepodcast.com. That's weepodcast.com. You can find everything that we've ever done is on that site. We got 2 podcasts that we do. Worst Episode Ever, a Simpsons podcast, and 90s Percentile. Worst Episode Ever is coming out on a bi-weekly basis every other Thursday. And 90s Percentile is on a bit of a hiatus, but we'll be coming back in a couple of weeks. So.
And
subscribe.
We have our commentary series, Sync Points. Every once in a while, we do random shit. We've been slowly building up our YouTube channel. Check that out.
There's a great video of us testing the camera. I forget what we were saying. We were just kind of dancing back and forth, so that's worth watching.
You guys were experimenting with Facebook Live for a little bit there. Is that still a thing?
We tried once.
We tried, yeah.
Like Periscope, for the most part, it didn't work last time. We like Periscope a lot. We like the interface. It's just nobody uses it. And Facebook, everybody uses, but the interface sucks.
We also get strange Russian teens who are like, what is this? Is this podcast?
Are you in New York?
You in New York? Let's go all the way this year. So check us out, wepodcast.com. You can get us on Twitter at WeStudiosPod. I'm individually at ThenDanSays.
I'm collectively at Jackie No Breaks.
And that's where we're at.
That's all. We have to probably give you our email. We can give you our whatever.
How about home addresses and social security numbers?
Well, funny you mentioned that. We're actually just, should we say? We set up a P.O. box if we're going to use eventually.
Yes, we're setting up a P.O. box for various nefarious reasons.
So you don't send us your mail bombs.
Because we don't want people to know where we live.
It's a great place to send beer that Dan will never get to taste.
There you go.
Try and send your friends some beer to be nice and fucking Jack drinks it all.
That's what you do with beer.
Yeah, Jack's a friend. That totally works.
Mission accomplished.
Matt, where can people find you?
On the toilet.
Yeah, that makes sense. Also, you can find him at Matt the Lifeguard on Twitter and Instagram.
I like how Corey has he's in charge.
I'm rocking it through. You can find me at donestcomics.com. Find the comics that I help make and publish every week.
That's a lot of fun. Are we going to start recording now?
I think we should actually start recording now. It's been about 3 hours since we started talking, so we should probably actually start.
Yeah, because I don't want any of that going live, because I said some weird racist, like white face stuff.
I wouldn't say it's weird coming from you, but all right.
Yeah, there's a lot of white face comments. Now that we got it all out,
so let's go live.
Go ahead. Let's start
the podcast. Hey, everybody. Welcome to Worst Episode Ever, a podcast for people who love The Simpsons by people with Simpsons. But how much we hate The Simpsons, we're here trying to find which is the worst episode ever.
And I'm Jack.
I'm also Jack.
I'm Jack.
I'm jacked.
In a way, we're all jacked.
I'm jacked in the pants. Got a big old jack boner.
That's what I call jack.
God. All right, are we done?
I was going to say, I call it a Matt boner, but he's too busy watching that USA show.
Wait, what?
That is, I get it, but
there's an actor named Matt Boner.
Matt.
He's great.
Boner. It's literally one extra loop.
Bomer. It's an M.
Was he on White Collar?
He was on White Collar. He was in The Nice Guys.
Right. Yeah.
Thanks to you guys, I forever have Matt Boner in my search history.
There you go.
Yeah, you can't. That's something you can't delete.
You're welcome.
Can't pretend it wasn't already there.
Yeah,
He does have a picture with Kelly Kapowski, and I'm really, really jealous.
Yeah, because she was on his show with him. So until next time, my name is Jack.
I would tongue plow Kelly Kapowski's stink ditch so hard.
And we'll see you in another decade.
I understood three words in that sentence. Two of them were Kelly Kapowski.
I'm putting my tongue in her butt.
Oh, I actually thought you meant her vagina.
No, I wouldn't call her vagina stink ditch.
Stink ditch. What a classy show we've chosen to be on, Jack.
Yeah, I mean, it's only Jesse. I mean, come on, we're talking about Kelly here.
Yeah. Kelly Kapowski, she's got a nice turd cutter on her.
Matt's going to go straight put up this year.
Thanks for listening to another episode of the podcast. Darryl, we'll talk to you guys next time.
My God. Is that him? Love you too, Ashley.
Yeah, right.
Satan. That's metal to me. I don't.
Satan. Just yelling Satan.
Somebody ping.
I mean, I am. Are we recording?
Thank you for hanging out with us.
I don't know.
I paused the recording.
Okay.
We're good.
Are we live?
It says we're live.
Oh, we're still live on YouTube.
Yeah.
Right. Oh boy.
All right. YouTube, we're going away now.